Could I ask members who are leaving the chamber to please do so, and so we can move on, hopefully very soon, to the next item of business? Everybody happy? So the next item of business is a debate on motion 294 in the name of Keith Brown on justice, recover, renew, transform. And I would invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call on Keith Brown, Cabinet Secretary, to speak to and to move the motion. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity today to consider some of the most important challenges facing our justice system. And I'd like to use this time to build on my recent, what I believe are productive discussions with the justice spokespeople of other parties on how we deliver on this government's ambition, which is to achieve a faster, fairer and more effective justice system for the people of Scotland. As has been the case for jurisdictions internationally, the COVID pandemic and the essential public health measures have posed severe challenges to the operation of our justice system. We are under no illusions when we consider the major impact of the pandemic. And as members across the chamber will be keen to highlight, I'm sure, there were existing pressures building across the justice system pre-COVID. It's therefore appropriate to reflect on the actions which have been taken and progress made across the sector during this period. The Scottish Government responded swiftly to the immediate challenges of COVID-19, and this Parliament passed the two Emergency Coronavirus Acts. These continue to be vital in providing powers and measures to help protect the public, maintain essential public services and to support the economy during the current outbreak of the coronavirus. One such example are remote jury centres, one of which I was fortunate enough to visit yesterday. And the use of jury centres based in cinema complexes has enabled jury trials dealing with the most serious cases to continue after they first restarted in July last year. The Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service quarterly statistical bulletin published last week showed that despite the challenges in some recent months at the High Court, evidence-led trials have been running at an even higher level than their pre-COVID levels. This is a huge achievement, and the resumption of court business was only possible because of the collaborative efforts to innovate and embrace new ideas by our justice partners, third sector organisations, judiciary and defence community. We should, in my view, in the Chamber today, praise all those involved in ensuring the continuation of justice during this most challenging period. But as is the position in England and Wales, the justice system in Scotland is facing challenges and significant backlogs in cases that cannot be addressed within existing capacity or resources. We have committed to an additional £50 million in this year's budget to further support recovery across the justice system, including increasing capacity in both the High Court and the Sheriff Court. Within our civil justice system, while backlogs remain, great progress has been made to manage recovery through the use of virtual proceedings, as well as electronic transfer of documents and innovative digital solutions. Throughout the pandemic, our community justice delivery partners, though greatly hampered by restrictions to deliver face-to-face service, have continued to support a wide range of community justice services, with a focus on prioritising vulnerable people and those who present an imminent and serious risk of harm. One of our key priorities throughout the pandemic was to ensure that victims continue to be supported, feel reassured, and that they have confidence in the justice system. We were particularly aware of the risks for women and children experiencing gender-based violence and provided an additional £5.75 million to frontline services so they could respond to an increase in demand from victims of abuse. We also increased Victim Support Scotland's Victims Fund to help meet the immediate financial needs of the most vulnerable victims during the pandemic. Our prisons are a unique setting, and additional measures have been required to keep those who live and work in prisons safe. Importantly, we took action to ensure those in prisons could maintain family contact through virtual visits and mobile phones or in-cell phones across the estate. And to the credit of prison and NHS staff, the virus has been well controlled within our prisons, although we must, of course, remain vigilant. A challenge remains in relation to remand, those who are in prison but have yet to have their trial or are awaiting their sentence. The number of people on remand has gone up during the pandemic at a time when overall prison numbers have reduced. While decisions on bail and remand are, of course, a matter for the independent judiciary, the Scottish Government has taken steps to ensure that community-based alternatives to remand are available. At the end of last year, the Scottish Government brought forward regulations to allow bail to be monitored electronically. A number of justice partners have been working to prepare for this change, and subject to all partners completing that work successfully, this can be fully commenced after the summer. I will do.
Jamie Green.
Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary if the proposed new coronavirus legislation which the government wants to introduce could potentially lead to an outcome where those in remand may stay in remand for up to a year if those powers exist?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm not sure, to be perfectly honest, about the connection he makes between the coronavirus powers and the extension of remand, and I'm happy to look at that further. But I think the changes in terms of the pandemic, which have led to an increased level of prisoners on remand, are pretty self-evident from the backlog in the courts. And the coronavirus restrictions, the new powers which have been taken, have helped to reduce that backlog by some of the measures which I've introduced. If I'm missing the point, then please, I'm happy to come back to the point that Jamie Green is trying to make, if that's not the point. As we emerge from the crisis, maintaining a legal aid sector will be crucial to recovery. We do value and appreciate hugely the role of the legal profession and the role it's played during the pandemic, which is why we've committed to bringing forward a package of measures worth up to £20 million to help support the legal aid sector, as well as delivering the first stage of a 10% increase in fees in March. Yes, I'll take an intervention.
Pauline McNeill.
Thank you to Cabinet Secretary for giving me, when we have discussed this question, but when we did the reform of sentencing to extend Sheriff Court powers to 5 years, it was always intended that in complex cases you would get legal aid for advocates, the counsel that is. Does the Cabinet Secretary think it's time to look at that, because it seems to be virtually impossible to get it now?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank the member for intervention and say we have discussed that previously, and she'll know on that call where officials, and I'm happy to come back to her with a fuller response. But I think if I can just lay out some of the measures that we have taken in response to the immediate pressures of the pandemic, and that may give us some comfort, but happy to come back with a fuller response in due course. So we have established a resilient fund worth up to £9 million and have recently provided another £1 million to help support legal traineeships. I do acknowledge, though, the concerns raised by some in the legal profession with regards to the Resilience Fund. We do remain absolutely committed to engaging with the profession and are working as a matter of urgency to explore options for the effective distribution of unallocated funds. I mean, part of the issue, of course, was having the facts and the data which would have helped support more rapid disbursement of that. So we are trying to work through that with partners. We are very clear that our ambition to recover the operation of the justice system also presents an opportunity to reinvigorate system-level improvements and take forward our manifesto commitments to deliver a faster, fairer and more effective justice system for Scotland. Our manifesto commitments aim to ensure victims' rights are at the very heart of Scotland's criminal justice system, to secure provision of support for children and young people, as well as the development of restorative justice services. And key to this will be the appointment of a victims commissioner to provide an independent voice for victims, while investment of £250,000 over 3 years to fund a trauma specialist at NHS Education for Scotland will help drive forward development of a trauma-informed and trauma-responsive workforce in justice services. We will also bring forward changes to ensure lifelong anonymity for complainers of sexual crimes, further increasing the confidence of victims to report crimes of this serious nature. We will engage with key stakeholders, including victims' organisations, to give serious consideration to the full set of recommendations from Lady Dorrien's review to deliver a justice system that survivors of sexual crimes can have confidence in. And it's worth pointing out that many of those provisions and recommendations interlock with each other, and I think it's best that they are taken forward, or consideration of them is taken forward, together at the same time. We have an aspiration to create our own Bairns House in Scotland, an unashamedly bold aspiration. We believe that every child, victim or witness has the right to consistent and holistic support which enables them to tell their stories, access specialist services and recover from their experiences. And we have committed to consult on the removal of the not proven verdict. It's fairly plain to me that amongst the various parties in this chamber there are different views within those parties, and it's right that we have a proper consultation and discussion on that. And once again, in common with my previous comments, the not proven verdict and what we do with that eventually will be very much dependent upon or have implications for other parts of the justice system, and for that reason it's best taken forward in that way. But we do recognise there's a very strong case that's been made for its abolition, but there are complex issues, and while I know many in the chamber support the move, it's right that we consider this very carefully. Throughout the next period of renewal for our justice system, we will continue to commit to engage with the legal profession and victim support organisations on the reform of the legal aid system taken forward by my colleague, the Minister. We will be taking a similarly collaborative approach in expanding the availability of mediation and arbitration and the regulation of legal services. The Crown Office has, at the direction of the outgoing Lord Advocate, significantly reformed the arrangements for the investigation of deaths and applied significant additional resources to this work. And these reforms have resulted in reductions in the duration of death investigations, and it is expected that they will continue to do so. Their full benefit needs to be allowed to work its way through the system, in my view, and the current Lord Advocate has welcomed engagement with justice spokespeople on this issue, and I look forward to future engagement with his successor, and I am sure he or she, whoever is appointed, will undertake that engagement with people across the chamber. Ensuring people and communities across Scotland are safe and resilient is vital and will play a key role in supporting our recovery and renewal from the pandemic. Throughout the pandemic, we have continued to invest money recovered from individuals that have been convicted in order to support people, families and communities. Yes, we'll give it.
Liam Kerr.
I'm very grateful. I just wonder if the Cabinet Secretary is going to be addressing policing at any point. And the reason I ask is I thought there was a good question at FMQs today about body-worn cameras. I didn't hear a clear answer at that point. I wonder if he can confirm that funding would be provided for a body-worn camera rollout.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank the member for the question? I did hear the First Minister and understood the First Minister's response, but the member may well know that we are willing to, first of all, investigate. There are a number of issues around body-worn cameras, which I'm sure the member is aware of, which the police themselves are aware of. And we should look through those issues, first of all, but there will be, for the police officers who will be attending COP26, Police Scotland officers, body-worn cameras for those armed officers, and we are looking at the further rollout of that in due course. So throughout the period of the renewal that we've talked about for our justice system, we will continue to engage with partners. The Crown Office has, as I've said, at the direction of the outgoing Lord Advocate, significantly reformed the arrangements for deaths and applied significant additional resources to that work coming from the Scottish Government. We will ensure people and communities across Scotland are safe as we do this. We will continue to invest the money recovered from individuals. So phase five of the Cashback for Communities programme, running until 2023, is providing £19 million to support diversionary activity and life-changing interventions to those most at risk of being involved in antisocial behaviour, offending and entering the justice system. Coming to the final two areas, I'd like to highlight, Presiding Officer, community justice and prisons. It's helpful to consider the context from the Hard Edges Scotland report from 2019, which showed that people in the criminal justice system commonly experience severe and multiple disadvantage, including homelessness, substance misuse, offending, mental ill health and domestic violence or abuse. And the latest statistics on prisons show that individuals from the 10% most deprived areas are overrepresented in prison arrivals by a factor of three, a finding consistent across the last decade. In addition, the proportion of individuals arriving in prison who report having no fixed abode has increased over a decade of austerity from 4.4% to 7.5%. And these are societal issues which need to be addressed beyond the justice system. By helping individuals earlier, we can also avoid these damaging impacts being visited on future generations. Our aim is that prisons should be reserved for individuals who pose a serious risk of harm and periods of imprisonment, particularly periods of remand and short custodial sentences, should only be imposed where there are no other alternatives. For those that do end up in custody, it's our commitment to continue to invest in the modernisation of the prison estate, ensuring it is fit for purpose. This includes completing the construction of the new transformative female estate and progressing with replacements for HMP Barlinnie and HMP Inverness. It's worth noting, of course, that the annual average cost per prisoner place for 2019-20 is over £38,000 a year. Short custodial sentences do little to reduce the likelihood of reoffending, which is why we extended the presumption against short sentences to 12 months or less in 2019. They disrupt families and communities, they impact on life chances and adversely affect employment opportunities and stable housing, the very things evidence shows support diversion from offending. The government sustained and long-term programmes to promote community safety, crime prevention and rehabilitation of individuals have meant less crime and fewer victims than a decade ago. And it's worth pointing out that the police service, as has been mentioned by one member, has done a fantastic job in helping to reduce crime over the last now 15 years. In developing a new national community justice strategy and exploring legislative options to divert people from prison, we aim to make our society safer for everyone, reducing reoffending, reducing recorded crime, and ultimately reducing the number of victims. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, an example of which we will see that kind of preventative work undertaken by the cross-cutting work that will be undertaken by my colleague, the Minister for Community Safety. She will be taking forward in particular a thematic approach in relation to the interaction of women in the justice system. We will be taking that forward in the following parliamentary term, setting out a clear and strategic approach to women in the justice system. And we have one of the most, thankfully, diverse parliaments ever elected. I'm very proud that my party has more female MSPs than male MSPs. We also generally have a more diverse parliament than previously, and also, I think, potentially a more progressive parliament than previously. It's a real opportunity to harness this diversity, to work collectively across different portfolios, hopefully across different parties as well, to address some systemic issues and bring forward progressive policies that will help steer us through the recovery to meet the challenges of the future. Presiding Officer, I move the motion in my name.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And could I now call on Jamie Green to speak to and move Amendment 294.1. Jamie Green, thank you.
Presiding Officer, I'm very pleased to be opening for the Scottish Conservatives in my first justice debate. I took on the education brief just a month before the pandemic hit, and we saw 15 months of unprecedented upheaval in the system. I now take on the justice portfolio 15 months into the same pandemic, which has equally shifted the floor from beneath the feet of our justice system. I'd like to pay tribute to my predecessor, Liam Kerr, and I wish the new Cabinet Secretary well. This truly is a tough gig. Those in the Chamber who I've worked with in the past will know that where there is common ground, I will seek to find it. And where there isn't, I will debate it respectfully and make my case. But reading today's motion and the amendments, I'm confident that there will be common ground on many issues, but perhaps not all. I don't expect agreement, perhaps, when we come to vote today, even. But nonetheless, I do want to kick off our justice debate constructively, because I accept that the events of the past year have created unexpected conundrums for us all. We are not alone in the emergence of criminal and court backlogs. But COVID only exacerbated an existing problem in Scotland, because nearly 50% of the current trial backlog existed pre-pandemic. We are not alone in the correlation that the emergency laws that we passed in this place have added to the workload of our frontline police. And we are not alone in being forced to innovate to find new ways of allowing justice to proceed. Because whilst we were tucked up in our houses, our frontline police, our ambulance, our fire, our prison staff, they continued their work on the front line, nose to nose with danger. And I think we all owe them a huge debt of gratitude. It's interesting, Presiding Officer, no one has sought to remove any words from the government motion today, but plenty has surely been added. And let me make two observations on that. First, the motion itself focuses very narrowly on the effects of the pandemic, with no real acceptance of some of the pre-existing problems that we faced. And secondly, it refers to plans to reform Scottish justice, a promise to make it fit for purpose in a modern world, but it does not explain how. Justice is an area where the Scottish Conservatives have proudly stood on a platform for clear reform. We make no apology for that. Reform, which resets the balance of focus on victims, on their views, on their rights, and we make no apology for that either. The government motion states that it is the interests of victims that should remain at the heart of necessary reforms. I agree with that, but they cannot be just words. We must follow through on that commitment. Our amendment is a starting point. We will introduce to the Parliament a Victims Bill. Now, this bill will contain a number of very specific actions that I think the government can take right now to truly shift the balance. The first of those two have been discussed in this place already, Michelle's Law and Suzanne's Law, and I think it's important we refresh our memories why. Michelle Stewart was murdered by John Wilson. He was approved for a temporary release and allowed back into the community after serving just 9 years in prison. Michelle's family were informed of his release by letter and had no say whatsoever in the matter. Her sister put it at the time, "The prospect of seeing my sister's killer on the street, on the bus or in the shops, is painful." And they asked us, why is this allowed to happen? Well, we didn't have an answer for them then, and I don't think we have an answer for them today. Michelle's Law will put that injustice right. Suzanne Pilley. Suzanne was killed by her partner in 2010, and he refused to say where her body lies. Margaret Fleming, Linda Spence, Arlene Fraser, the list goes on and on. Suzanne's Law would ensure that those who refuse to reveal the bodies of their victims will not be eligible for parole until they do so. And it is sadly too often the case that the legislative reform needed is named after the names of the individual victims, and often women who have suffered at the hands of evil, a point validly raised by Labour's amendment, which I think seeks to try and find a solution to the trauma of how we process domestic abuse and sexual violence cases in our courts. But I can't support their amendment because I think we should do this justice and hold a proper debate into the findings of Lady Dorrien's recommendations. And there are many, but I would like to know the implications of those implications. I think we can do that as a parliament positively and constructively. Nonetheless, these are all very sombre issues to grapple with. But I think it would send an immediate and very powerful nod to victims in Scotland that we as a parliament are on their side if we make speedy progress on these issues. Yes.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank the member for taking the intervention and just say that I'm more than willing for my part to engage in that discussion. You'll have heard what I've said already about a victims commissioner and additional trauma support for victims as well. But would he acknowledge that the changes that we have very recently made, which came into effect on the 21st of March, both in relation to the cases of what he's termed Michelle's Law and Suzanne's Law, do take that substantially further down the road? And when he does bring forward a bill, if that's what happens, will he take into account those, which I would think were very welcome changes for the Conservatives?
Jamie Green.
They're welcome changes, but they're not going far enough, nor are they going fast enough. We go back to November 2019, when then Justice Secretary Hamza Yousaf stated they would make speedy progress on this issue. The families of these victims, and there are many victims, are sitting there watching this Parliament drag its feet on these issues. That's why we're bringing forward a bill on these matters in the first 100 days of this Parliament, and rightly so. We also call for proper budgeting support for victims and support services around that. The third sector, and I think it's important to recognise this, plays a crucial role in supporting victims and being that first port of call. But equally, the third sector can play a vital role in the preventative agenda. And I think that's one that merits sensible discussion across the chamber. I note the Green Party amendment alludes to this. I don't disagree. 4 in 10 prisoners in Scotland report to have taken drugs in prison. Not before, not outside, in the prison itself. Nearly half of them were under the influence of drugs at the time of their arrest. Scotland has the worst drug problem in Europe. These two statistics do not live in isolation, presiding officer. And sadly, it is often prison staff who bear the brunt of this. Next in our amendment, we are calling for the doubling of sentences on crimes against emergency services workers. This is a call which has largely fallen on deaf ears in recent years. Our view is simply clear on this. It is only right that those who go out of their way to harm our frontline personnel are punished accordingly. Why? Because Scottish police staff were attacked on average 20 times a day last year. 50% of our police officers are facing burnout, according to the Federation. The Scottish Police Memorial, which sits in the grounds of the Scottish Police Scotland College, should serve as a stark and very visible reminder of that sacrifice that they have paid for anybody in this chamber who is in any doubt about the gravity of this issue. I really have a lot to cover, thank you. Next, I want to reaffirm our position on the presumption against short sentences. Now, I listened carefully to what the Cabinet Secretary said. I presume that the rationale behind that was that they wanted more offenders to have alternatives to prison, and that is fine. But what happened to those alternatives? Because we know that 300,000 hours of community service sentences were white, slate, clean. The alternative must be meaningful. The alternative must command the confidence of the public who have the right to understand that justice has truly been served. And the final call on our amendment, as alluded to, is the anomaly of Scotland's not proven verdict. Now, I admit that there are mixed views on this, within the chamber, perhaps, and also within the legal profession. But that in itself cannot and should not be a barrier to ending what has long been a very curious, often misunderstood, and often controversial verdict in Scots law. It is abundantly clear that there are structural issues that must take place in Scotland. How can our legal institutional frameworks be improved to truly better serve victims and their families? I'm in my closing minutes, I apologise. This is a point raised, I think, by the Liberal Democrats, so they've moved, apologies, on fatal accident inquiries. A very valid point, a position which these benches will support at decision time. This also ties in with the much-needed reform of the role of the Lord Advocate. The First Minister herself acknowledges and concedes that, following the saga of the Alex Salmond trial. The shambolic and wrongful prosecution of two men in relation to the sale of Rangers Football Club, which cost the taxpayers £20 million and rising, I think it points towards embedded flaws which still remain unaddressed, and they must be addressed if we stand a chance of full public confidence. Presiding Officer, none of the above is restrictive. There is a crisis of recruitment and retention within our legal aid sector. For example, one defence lawyer said that we are staring into an abyss. Trouble for the sector now is trouble for the entire system in the future. And he is so right. The whole system is creaking at the seams. I don't think the topic of judicial reform should be controversial. A parliament which collectively agrees to reset the balance of our justice system back into the interests of victims must and should find common ground to do so. But equally, where clear blue water exists in our approach, these benches are proud. Proud to be the voice of those in society whose own rights have often been lost in this debate. If the government is serious about shifting the sands towards victims, then it must show it. It must show it through action. If the victims' law does not materialise in government time, then we will put it on the radar in ours. And let others put barriers in its way at their peril. We owe it to those victims. It's time to act, Presiding Officer. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you. I now call on Polly McNeill to speak to and move amendment 294.3. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I move the amendment in my name. Can I begin by thanking the Cabinet Secretary and Ash Denham, Minister, for meeting with me yesterday, and I hope that we can continue to work in that fashion. And I too, like Jamie Graham, am delighted to lead for Scottish Labour on the justice brief in this new Parliament, and I'm delighted to say that I will be joined by Katie Clark, who will bring her knowledge and passion to the brief, and I look forward to her first speech today. It's been a long while since I've had any involvement in justice issues. I was saying that to Cabinet Secretary only last week. I served as the chair of the Justice Committee what seems like a century ago. I presided over the internationally renowned fingerprint evidence inquiry. So I have a lot of catching up to do, so please bear that in mind. The approach I want to take is similar to the approach that Jamie Green has outlined this afternoon, is to find common ground with the Scottish Government and the other parties to work to make a difference to the everyday experiences of victims in our system, to apply human rights and fairness in sentencing and in our prisons, to recognise the work of Police Scotland, but to ensure accountability for the decisions they make, and not just in the tragic case of Sheikh Bayo, who died in custody. And we desperately need answers on this, but in all cases, we need accountability. I don't understand why the previous Cabinet Secretary did not stand up for police officers on the front line in relation to early vaccination. We know that 40 officers caught the virus after proceeding over public disorder in Glasgow only a few weeks ago. But Scottish Labour recognises the importance of a progressive justice system with alternatives to custody and investment in community service and other alternatives. There is an urgent need to tackle the backlog of cases which has left victims waiting longer for justice. We also need to ensure that our courts are not overusing remand in prisons, a practice that is putting pressure on already overcrowded prisons and people who we need to remember are not convicted prisoners. A recent report shows that for young adult prisoners aged 16 to 20, almost half of them were on remand, and we need an answer as to why so many young offenders are in custody awaiting trial. So I also want to indicate that some of my work in this role is looking and tackling violence against women in our society. It will be a central theme of my work, and that's why I particularly welcome the contribution of Ash Denham, who I know is going to be doing very serious work on this. Like everywhere in the world, violence against women and girls is widespread in Scotland, and at least one in five women in Scotland will experience domestic abuse in her lifetime, and an average of four rapes is reported per day. But the crime is chronically underreported. We've said so many times in this Parliament, these figures will mask the true extent of sexual violence. I'm also pleased to work with Rhoda Grant, who will be summing up into the debate, and the work that she has done on violence against women. If you need to be convinced of that, after the high-profile cases of Sarah Everard, Libby Squires, Bieber Henry and Nicole Smallman, and the elderly lady Esther Brown, who was raped and killed in her flat in Woodlands in Glasgow last Tuesday, and many other women, then listen to the eight-part podcast by Sam Pooling, BBC Scotland, on Who Killed Emma. Emma Caldwell, who was murdered 16 years ago and her body found in woods near Roberton in South Lanarkshire, and it's the testimony of the women who knew Emma, who were working in Glasgow's red light area, as it was known at the time, who say that they were regularly assaulted and raped by men, but the complaints were not taken seriously. And I believe that any attack on any woman is unacceptable, and every woman should be treated as a human being. No one has been brought to justice for Emma's killing, and the case was reopened in 2015 but has stalled despite a key suspect being named in the report to the Crown Office in 2018. The biggest manhunt in the history of Strathclyde Police continues to be unsolved, and the killer of Emma Caldwell remains free, and that leaves the family of Emma still without justice, while also obviously threatening the lives of other women. And I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary would commit that he and the next Lord Advocate will treat this as a priority. I would be happy to give way if you wish.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank the member for her challenge? But she will know, I'm sure, that the decisions on investigations are for the investigatory authorities. But just to say, she has said in her own words about the level of resource and effort that the police have put into this, and I'm sure that will continue. And I'm happy to raise it with the new Lord Advocate when that person's appointed.
Polly McNeill.
I really do appreciate that. Talking about the prime suspect in the case, investigative journalist Sam Poling said, all the evidence I've seen suggests this man is incredibly sexually violent towards women and has serious questions to answer about the murder of Emma Caldwell. Sarah Everard's death also painted a clear picture of flaws in our society on the handling of gender-based violence. Authorities advise women to stay home to protect themselves and not walk alone at night, sparking outrage. The recommendations put the onus on women to stop gender-based violence, is often the case. So we therefore must be clear in this Parliament that we will stand up for women and demand safer streets. Data on forecast scheduled trials from Scottish courts suggests that the number of criminal cases which are registered but still waiting trial at the end of April 2021 was nearly 50,000, more than double the number in April 2020. And the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service has predicted that the backlog will not be cleared until 2025. And yesterday, I'm aware that Cabinet Secretary for Justice wasn't able to put a date on the backlog and when it will be cleared. But I hope we can have more detailed discussions on that. I'd be happy to give way.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank the member for taking intervention? Just to say that, of course, that's what the Court Service says and that's what the figures suggest should be. The point I was making yesterday, it should be down to all of us to see if we can truncate and bring forward that backlog by taking some of the measures that I've mentioned. So that is the scale of the challenge that faces not just Scotland but other jurisdictions. But if we can work together to try and reduce that, we'll all benefit from that.
Polly McNeill.
Thank you. So let's see what progress we can make, but I totally acknowledge that point. Like Jamie Green, I want to also make a point about legal aid, which has become scarcity in many cases and has driven many good lawyers from the profession. It not only impacts on the accused, but it does actually impact on the whole of the system as a whole. It's not just good housekeeping. We need to make sure it's good justice as well. Justice denied is not just justice denied to the accused, but also to victims. So I am really pleased that the Cabinet Secretary specifically mentioned this point. On wider reform, it is time to separate out the role of the Lord Advocate and the Solicitor General to protect the integrity of the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. And in Labour's amendment, we highlight the review group chaired by Lord Justice Clark, Lady Dory, and I want to make clear to the Conservative benches that we are not acknowledging or accepting all of the recommendations, but we want to simply highlight them. Because she has recommended a new specialist court that should be created to deal with sexual offences. And we must remember that men are victims of violence, of sexual crimes. Although far fewer men than women are raped and sexually assaulted, the effects are just as devastating. But Lady Dorian said that the review was prompted in particular by the growth in the volume and complexity of sexual offending cases. Finally, it is clear that we do need to have anonymity for complaints of sexual offences, and many people think this is the case already, but it is not. In closing, Presiding Officer, I just want to say about the amendments. We will be supporting the amendment by the Scottish Liberal Democrats. There is a lot in the Conservative amendment which we can support, and we do support the idea of a more victim-centred system. We do believe that short-term sentences and alternatives to custody are central to a justice system. And we also think that the emergency workers legislation and the current framework of legislation should give sheriffs the necessary provisions to be able to give heavy sentences to those who attack emergency workers. In relation to the Green amendment, I would be grateful if Maggie Chapman...
Ms McNeill, could you bring your remarks to close, please?
Yes, could just clarify. Sorry, I was told Presiding Officer had 9 minutes. Okay.
It's down here
if the Greens, if I could just finish on this point, if you don't mind. It would be helpful to us to know when it comes to decision time, what the Green Amendment means by institutionally violent, because a lot in it we would like to support. Thank you very much, President.
Thank you. And I now call Maggie Chapman to speak to and move Amendment 294.4, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I move the amendment in my name. I'd like to begin by expressing my heartfelt thanks to all of those involved in supporting survivors and victims of all forms of violence throughout the pandemic. As is recorded in my register of interests, I have spent my most recent pre-election life working for a rape crisis centre. I have seen the consequences of lockdown and social isolation on people trapped in violent, abusive and unhealthy environments. We still live in a deeply patriarchal society where the abuse of power causes life-changing, sometimes life-ending, physical and mental harm. We should not accept this as inevitable. What I have also seen is the mind-blowing resilience of so many survivors, the mutual support they can give each other when adequate resources allow for safe and confidential sharing of stories, where they are believed, where they are not judged. So I want to pay tribute to the work of all those who provide these safe spaces, supporting survivors of gender-based violence, often putting their own well-being at risk. Vicarious trauma is real. Workers who support survivors of gender-based, and I dare say other forms of violence, are subjected to the risk of vicarious trauma on a daily basis. These workers do phenomenally important work and are also incredibly resilient. But we should not have to rely on the resilience of individuals. Gender-based violence, indeed I believe most violence, is not inevitable. It is a product of oppression. It is a consequence of often intersecting inequalities. It is a direct result of imbalances of power. And this brings me to what I fundamentally believe our justice system should be about. Our justice system should exist to correct imbalances of power. Equality in front of the law is fundamental to any democratic society. Our justice system should focus on doing what it can to correct the power inequalities that exist in our society as a result of gender, race, employment status, wealth, and other issues that so often cause division. A justice system that seeks to redress abuses of power is of vital importance to a fair, equal, safe, secure, and well society. But the system we have inherited is one that acts in the interests of the powerful in too many instances. The unjust use of power that leads to people being killed in the workplace, such as the Stockline disaster of 2004, where 9 people died and 33 were injured because a corporation didn't take health and safety laws seriously enough. Their penalty? £400,000 fine, just under £45,000 per person per life. The woefully low rate of prosecution of men who rape and sexually assault women, and the lack of trauma-informed support available to traumatised survivors. Abuses of power that mean BAME people are shamefully overrepresented in prisons and are often disproportionately the victims of hate crime. Abuses of power that result in prisons being used overwhelmingly to incarcerate the poor while failing to reduce offending. Where communities have to live with the negative consequences of environmental injustices, like those living in the shadow of Moss Morran, where the community have had their lives ruined by continuous flaring, visible from the other side of the Forth, sirens, and dangerous hydrocarbon pollution. While the Health and Safety Executive has finally submitted a prosecution to the Procurator Fiscal, do we really think that an individual causing this level of social damage would have been left unprosecuted for all of these years? And in our prisons, we have shamefully high levels of suicide and self-harm. I know I'm not the only one to have been affected by the death, just over 3 years ago, of Katie Allen, a victim of bullying. Since Katie died, there have been more than 20 suicides in our prisons. We urgently need to transform the culture of our prisons so that they can focus on reducing offending. We have to right these wrongs. We must take a preventative approach. Prevention produces better outcomes for individuals, for families, and for communities. Education, youth work, and social work can play key roles in crime prevention. These also help to create social capital, social solidarity, and to build community, but they need to be adequately resourced. Communities should also be involved in the planning and delivery of these services. Spending resources on early intervention and education is vital and is also a crucial part of justice and crime prevention, any justice and crime prevention programme. Early intervention, we know, can help identify risk factors as well as explore ways in which people can develop to their fullest potential. And supporting interventions at the points where people come into contact with the criminal justice system is important. For instance, women in prisons are vulnerable. Many are there because of histories of abuse and substance dependency. They need support and treatment, often not incarceration. And I will send Pauline McNeill the information on institutional violence. There is a lot in women's prisons particularly that I think we really, really need to address. The Netherlands actually has done an interesting thing in this area. It has reduced crime by taking a radical stance against prisons. In fact, they've closed more than half of their prisons. And this frees up resources that can be used to prevent crime rather than simply dealing with its effects. Presiding Officer, in closing, I have spoken in this chamber already about care and how the care ethic should form the foundation of our economy. I have also spoken about holistic approaches that take account of underlying causes of inequalities. Both of these are vital to our justice system too. And I look forward to working with others across this chamber to deliver the transformation our justice system needs and our country deserves. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Liam MacArthur to speak to and move Amendment 294.2.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Can I too start by welcoming the Cabinet Secretary, Jamie Green, and Maggie Chapman to their new roles, and Pauline McNeill back to her old stomping ground. She'll find that many of the issues haven't moved on a great deal since last she was on the brief. It feels strange to be the lone survivor on the justice brief from the last session, but I very much look forward to working collaboratively again across the chamber on some of the pressing issues affecting our justice system that have already been identified in the speeches so far. And we're at a critical juncture. Everywhere we look, the pandemic has exposed and exacerbated existing weaknesses. In justice, the weak seams were already close to giving way. Victims often said their experience of court was actually worse than the experience of crime itself. And the court case backlog was a source of real concern over 12 months ago. Pre-COVID, Scottish Liberal Democrat research found that over 50,000 cases breached the 26-week target from caution or charge to verdict. That's around one in three cases. Against that backdrop, it's no great surprise that 2025 is perhaps the earliest we can expect the current backlog to be dealt with. So new thinking, new ways of doing things are needed, and that includes the Crown Office. It's not working for anyone, not for victims, not for witnesses, not for those who offend, and not for the people working within it, despite their best efforts. We need to be honest about the problems that we face, and my amendment speaks to just one area crying out for reform. I know others in this chamber, and we've heard it already this afternoon, recognise that the current system of fatal accident inquiries isn't working. In 2019, Scottish Liberal Democrats revealed the extent of the FAI backlog. We found an outstanding inquiry into two deaths that had been waiting for 8 years. We found another completed in 2014-15 that occurred 10 years after the death. At the time, I said that waiting a decade to learn the circumstances of a loved one's death was scandalous. Since then, reports of decade-long delays keep coming forward. The inquiry into deaths of four in the Super Puma helicopter crash off the coast of Sumbria in Shetland in 2013 completed just last year. The inquiry into the death of Stanislaw Banya in 2010 concluded in August 2020. The inquiry into the death of Bogislaw Kopić, who died in March 2011, concluded in March 2021. Meanwhile, the inquiry into the deaths of John Yule and Lamara Bell in 2015 in that tragic crash on the M9 is yet to begin. And
Christine Graham.
I'm not defending extraordinary delays, but do you accept that sometimes there has to be a health and safety inquiry, an aerospace inquiry, which will prevent an FAI proceeding, or if there's criminal proceedings yet again, the FAI inquiry is held and is stopped in its tracks?
Lee MacArthur.
I would certainly accept that there are mitigating circumstances in some instances, and therefore it would, I think, emphasise the importance of keeping families of those victims informed throughout the process, and I don't even think that has necessarily happened. But that, Presiding Officer, speaks to a system that is broken. It's difficult to imagine the pain and frustration that loved ones must feel when such tragedy is followed by such a long silence. Scottish Liberal Democrats want a full independent review to consider if the FAI system should be removed as a Crown Office responsibility altogether. Assurances from the Scottish Government and Lord Advocate, promises of extra funding to fix the problems, have simply failed to deliver the change that's required. In England, Wales and Northern Ireland, a distinct service handles such inquiries, an independent challenge function that keeps things moving. My amendment calls for a review to consider this and other options for kick-starting reform of the checks and balances in our justice system. This would also open up the opportunity to reflect on whether the Lord Advocate's role as both a prosecutor and the government's main legal adviser is appropriate. That's not a new question, but in the later months of the last Parliament, the apparent conflict of interest between those duties came into sharper focus and in for sharper criticism. Separate positions with an independent Director of Prosecutions to run the COPFS could bring both focus to the task of recovery and justice, and with it a healthier separation of powers. Even the impression of a conflict risks undermining the integrity of such an important role. I raised this with the First Minister last month, and we welcome more detail from the Cabinet Secretary on the Government's plans for a review. Presiding Officer, I'm painfully aware of the many other issues that I've not been able to touch on. I may turn on to them in closing remarks, not least in relation to offender management and prisons. Our prisons are full to overflowing. We have a rate of incarceration in Scotland that is shameful, higher than almost every other country in Europe. No less shameful is the conditions in which many of those being held find themselves. Cells built by the Victorians for one are being used to house two. Experts question whether or not this is compliant with human rights law. Moreover, a quarter of those being held haven't even been convicted of a crime. The remand population is completely out of control. Presiding Officer, I'm pleased the Government's motion speaks of transformation and welcome to the amendments from Pauline McNeill and Maggie Chapman. I hope there's a genuine willingness to take the steps necessary to deliver the transformation we need to see in our justice system. And I move the amendment in my name. Thank you.
Thank you. We now move to the open debate, and members wishing to participate may wish to ensure that they've pressed their request to speak buttons. And I call Michelle Thompson to be followed by Pam Gosell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I plan to address two areas in this short speech. Firstly, I'd like to commend the Scottish Government's commitment to creating a register of interest for members of the judiciary. I also congratulate the legal journalist Peter Cherby for his long-standing commitment to this principle stemming from his petition of 2012. Now, in preparing for this, I read with interest the arguments for and against this proposal, particularly those of the Right Honourable Lord Carloway. He draws heavily on the refresh statement of judicial ethics in arguing that there is no need for change. I take a consequentialist or end result approach to the ethics of this matter rather than a rule-based or deontological approach. In other words, we as public servants in this place fully accept the need for a register of our pecuniary interests, not only because of the risk of our interests affecting our lawmaking, but also the perception that they may influence our lawmaking. The end, in this case, does indeed justify the means. We fully accept we have both a duty and an obligation to do this in bearing the privilege of acting and being paid as servants of the public. So what makes judges different? Surely, as Professor Alan Paterson of Strathclyde University notes, transparency is part and parcel of accountability. Lord Carloway further states, and I quote, "I remain of the view that any monitoring of judicial conduct, including judges' interests relative to the performance of their duties, should remain a matter for the judiciary and not for government or parliament." Really? This can only be described as judiciary marking their own homework. And this leads me on to my second key section of this speech, that of the Law Society marking their own homework in the form of lawyers regulating lawyers. Now, I must declare an interest in this area, being one of the few complainants who have successfully navigated the vagaries of the Law Society processes. Despite, I hope, not being without intellectual means, as a consumer, I found the process complex, opaque, and time-consuming. It's my belief and it's my belief, that the overarching legislation that governs this process is not fit for purpose nor of its time. Other disciplines, such as the medical or charity sectors, have long since moved away from marking their own homework and the application of beyond all reasonable doubt as a test. There are clearly critical issues with the processes adopted, which are contrary to the principles of better regulation and particularly the need to be consistent, accountable and transparent. I support the calls for reform from the Esther Robertson review. She said, "I concluded that those who use legal services and those that deliver those services will be best served in the future by independent regulation that meets internationally recognised regulation principles." Ms Robertson was not alone, as more recently the CMA noted, separating regulation from representation will increase trust in the sector and result in better regulation. Now, the Cabinet Secretary has accountability for a huge portfolio, and I respect the fact that the challenges to recover, renew and transform justice are significant. At some point, not today, I hope to ask the Minister about the status of the public consultation, which sought to seek consensus on the way forward with regard to the future of the legal services regulatory framework for Scotland. However, I would note that this consensus or compromise may prove elusive, and this appears to be the view of some within the Law Society themselves. Recently, an article in Legal Practice Management by Neil Stevenson, the Chief Executive of the Scottish Legal Complaints Commission, questioned, "If a compromise is found, is that a compromise in the best interests of the profession and the public, or a compromise between organisations with understandable vested interests?" In closing, I note that Stevenson quotes Stephen Mason, who undertook a review of legal regulation in England and Wales. Mason notes, "The regulatory framework should better reflect legitimate needs and expectations of the more than 90% of the population for whom it is not currently designed, and that is consumers." Thank you.
Thank you. I call Pam Gosell to be followed by Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First of all, I'd like to wish good luck to everybody delivering their maiden speeches today. I know how it feels and it's very proud. I stood here last week and I delivered mine. I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate. This is my first speech in this debate in the Chamber, and it's on an issue that everybody really here has something to relate to. Think about it. Do you really feel safe in our homes, at work, kids at school, walking down our streets? Who is responsible for keeping us safe, and who is supposed to protect us when we are most vulnerable? It does not give me great joy in asking people today whether they feel safe in their homes, at work or when walking down the streets. Justice, victims, catching criminals. These are issues which should be at the heart of the governing in our country. But what do we see these things really mean for the SNP? Before the pandemic, violent crime rose for the last 5 years, with non-sexual crimes of violence having risen by 50% between 2014-15 and 2019-20. I ask you, is this acceptable, Cabinet Secretary? The SNP spend double the amount on criminals than victims, £43.1 million on offender service in 2021-22. But for those that are victims at the hands of these criminals, is a miserly £18.2 million. I ask you, is this fair, Cabinet Secretary? Most areas in Scotland have fewer frontline police on the beat since the SNP police merger. I ask you, is this the SNP taking crime seriously? I'm going to hold on. I'm hoping that you can basically respond to when you're summing up, if I can get on with some of the words here. If I can speak to the SNP 2016 promises broken on the flagship victim surcharge fund, the SNP didn't provide a fifth of this money they pledged. I asked you, is this supporting the most vulnerable society, Cabinet Secretary? Only half of the violent crimes are going to jail. I asked you, is this sending the message out that the government are fighting criminals, Cabinet Secretary? The criminal court trials backlog. more than doubled in a year and will not be cleared for years. I ask you, is this a government that is taking the responsibility seriously, Cabinet Secretary? We are at breaking point due to the poor management and effectiveness of the SNP in Scotland. Presiding Officer, this is not what the Scottish people deserve from the SNP Scottish Government. We need to do better. The SNP Government is playing with people's lives and livelihoods. The Scottish courts and the Tribunal Services say it will take 4 years for the court backlogs to reach a sense of normality. This is not good enough. How many victims will have to wait for justice to be served? How many families will have to go through emotional torment while the perpetrators and the criminals are able to evade justice? After 14 years of failure from this government, letting down the people of Scotland, I am surprised that the government are still pushing their dividing separatist agenda. And before they blame the United Kingdom government, let us remind you that justice is a devolved power, meaning the SNP Scottish government are responsible for ensuring people's safety in their communities. Our communities deserve to see their police force on the streets. When is it the last time you saw some police on the beat? Today, they are nowhere to be seen. Why? The SNP centralisation. There was once a time when victims were at the heart of the justice system and criminals were treated like criminals. Today, criminals in Scotland are treated better than the victims. Why? SNP favour this. Our emergency workers are true heroes and have showed incredible bravery during the coronavirus pandemic. It is disturbing to see that there has been 851 assaults on emergency workers in the west of Scotland during the pandemic, when these workers are keeping Scotland safe. Presiding Officer, I'd like to move on to knife crime. Knife crime is a blight on our communities that has no place in a civilised society, but where I live in East Dumbartonshire, there has been a worrying spike in knife and violent crime. Just 2 weeks ago, a gang of youths out of a car wearing balaclavas stabbed a 17-year-old before chasing him nearly half a mile. In addition to this, last week, a 24-year-old man was rushed to hospital with serious injuries after being attacked by two men with knives. I want to stand here today and give confidence to our residents, but the reality is these crimes could happen to any one of us. It is just not good enough, and the SNP need to step up, take the fight to the criminals, or step aside and let the Scottish Conservatives do the job they are failing to do. The Scottish Conservatives would keep dangerous offenders off the streets, restore local policing and champion victims' rights. This is a change that we want to see for 100 days, the next 100 days, from the Scottish Government. Actions, not words. If the SNP are serious about tackling crime, they will work together with the Scottish Conservatives to give victims the protection they deserve with the Victims' Law and put the criminals behind bars. There are no excuses. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Rona Mackay to be followed by Katie Clark.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Before I start my speech, I'd just like to say that Pam Gosal asked an awful lot of questions there but wasn't prepared to listen to the answers, which seems very odd. So I'm very pleased to be speaking in this important debate this afternoon at such a challenging time for our justice system on many levels. Firstly, can I reiterate the Scottish Government motion and commend the commitment and innovation of our justice partners and stakeholders in keeping the wheels of justice turning during the pandemic by introducing the many innovative solutions that have been adopted to address the mounting caseload and to clear the backlog. As Deputy Convener of the Justice Committee in the last session, I know how quickly and efficiently resources such as remote jury centres and cinemas were set up to address the mounting caseload and tackle the backlog while civil business was moved online. All this was helped by an additional £50 million in this year's Scottish Government budget to support recovery across the justice system. Setting up these centres has enabled pre-pandemic capacity to be restored for solemn business. It's hugely inventive and state-of-the-art solution to the challenges around jury trials faced by jurisdictions around the world. As we slowly emerge from the pandemic, the SNP government will undertake a review of Scotland's prosecution system to deliver fairer, faster and more effective justice. The criminal justice system must now focus on three things: recover, returning to the pre-pandemic capacity and addressing backlogs across the whole system. Good progress in this has been made, and with the resumption of Sheriff Court summary criminal trials in April, these already returned to 61% of the pre-COVID average. However, we must be realistic about the backlog and the effect this has had on victims whose trials have been postponed, particularly victims of sexual crimes. Their pain has increased immeasurably.
Ms Mackay, if I may just stop you momentarily, could I just ask that you lift your microphone up? Thank you.
Sorry, Presiding Officer, apologies. Their pain has increased immeasurably due to the unavoidable delay caused by the pandemic. We must renew, prioritise the resolution of cases at the earliest opportunity and embed new ways of working. Crucially, our manifesto sets out a wide range of commitments aimed at ensuring victims' rights are at the heart of Scotland's criminal justice system. So I'm pleased that we'll continue to support victims' groups and appoint a victims' commissioner to provide an independent voice for victims and witnesses. And we need to transform, change outcomes for those affected by the criminal justice system. Presiding Officer, that brings me nicely onto a subject very close to my heart. As convener of the cross-party group on women's justice, we know that there are many issues that affect women and their families that we must address, as previous speakers have outlined. And I'm pleased that there's a new focus on this from the government, and I thank the Minister for meeting with me earlier. There are still far too many women in prison, women who've been the victims of much more serious offences than they've been accused of. Many are victims of physical, emotional and sexual abuse, including coercive control or childhood trauma, which can, of course, be a driver for their offending. Colleagues, if you remember anything from my plea to keep women out of prison, it is this. It's estimated that 8 out of 10 women in custody at any time have suffered head injuries predominantly caused by a domestic abuse. It doesn't take a genius to see that prison is not the place for them. It wrecks families and lives. Holistic mentoring can be the alternative to prosecution, and I'm pleased that we've been with so many excellent agencies able to provide this. Our cross-party group wrote to the previous Cabinet Secretary for Justice asking for diversion from prosecution, alternatives to remand and residential rehabilitation pathways for women, and I know these are being currently considered. Presiding Officer, I'm delighted that the review will consider reform of corroboration and the three verdict system, including, in recognition of the strong case that can be made for abolition, a consultation on the removal of the not proven verdict, as the Cabinet Secretary outlined, and that Lady Dorrien's review will be part of this. I welcome this discussion. Corroboration and not proven are the key reasons why for such a low prosecution rate in sexual crimes, and this needs addressed urgently. The Scottish Government will develop a new funding regime for victim support organisations and introduce a justice-specific knowledge and skills framework for trauma-informed practice. Presiding Officer, I'm overjoyed that we will reform how children and young people are treated by the justice system and introduce the Barnehus. In the last session, the Justice Committee visited Norway to see a model of the Barnehus, which most Scandinavian countries have introduced. It's safe to say that we were blown away by what we witnessed. At present, young people caught up in the justice system have to go to many, multiple different services in multiple locations. In the Barnehus, all the care and support a child and their family needs is delivered under one roof in a welcoming and safe environment. The Scottish Government is also investing significant levels of funding in frontline support services to ensure the victims of gender-based violence can safely access the support they need. And I echo all the comments from Maggie Chapman and Polly McNeill on this. Of the recently reported rise in convictions for violence in 2019-20, more than half were accounted for by the new offences under Scotland's new Domestic Abuse Act. By strengthening our domestic abuse laws, such as the introduction of domestic abuse protection orders passed in the last session, the Scottish Government has provided police and prosecutors with greater powers to tackle this insidious crime. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I look forward to the Government's progressive and transformative review of justice to address issues in modern Scotland. We know that the legal system in Scotland has a proud and world-renowned heritage, but that shouldn't mean that it's keeping it in aspic and that improvements can never be made. I believe that's the point we've now reached. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Katie Clark to be followed by James Dornan, and this is Ms Clark's first speech in this chamber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and it's a huge pleasure to be able to make my first speech in this Parliament and to take this opportunity to thank everybody who supported me to get here to be a Labour representative for the West of Scotland and to all in this Parliament for their kindness during the first few weeks. I welcome this debate about how we return to pre-pandemic capacity in the justice system, how we address the backlog in cases, what can be learnt from our experiences during COVID, and most importantly, how we transform a system which so often in the past has failed victims and indeed sometimes accused too. And also often a system which has failed to prevent crime or provide rehabilitation. As Pauline kindly said, I have experience working as a solicitor in the Scottish courts, and I've also been involved in campaigning on civil liberties and human rights issues over many years. I also worked for the trade unions Unison as a lawyer, taking legal cases on behalf of workers, and with a team who dealt with thousands of criminal injury compensation cases on behalf of workers who were injured at work. The Criminal Injuries Compensation Scheme was designed to give compensation to victims of crimes, but has been eroded again and again over the decades, indeed, by the UK Conservative government, which is quite interesting given some of the comments we've heard in this chamber today. However, whilst criminal injuries compensation is a devolved area, the Scottish Government continues to take part in the UK Government scheme. So I hope that during my time in this Parliament, I will be able to persuade the Scottish Government to introduce a scheme in Scotland which adequately compensates the victims of crimes for injuries. The amendment which Labour has put down today puts emphasis on the continued prevalence of violence against women in society. And Pauline McNeill, Maggie Chapman and Rona Mackay have already spoken powerfully about the importance of women in the justice system. The amendment acknowledges that COVID-19 restrictions have increased the risks for women who are victims of violence and indeed has hindered their access to justice. The amendment calls for the creation of specialist domestic abuse and sexual offences courts, and I urge the government to look at that as a matter of urgency, because the reality, of course, is that violence against women is endemic in society, and recent figures yet again have shown the numbers of crimes that are linked to domestic violence, and indeed the levels of convictions for offences such as rape and attempted rape. Out of the 2,344 reported rapes and attempted rapes in the most recent statistics, there were only 130 convictions. The criminal justice system fails women, and this Parliament's job is to ensure that they get justice. It is also our duty to make sure everybody's fundamental rights in society are protected, and indeed that includes the right to protest. And when we are debating issues round about justice, I think we have to remember that the backdrop to this debate is the emergency COVID legislation, which has given the state unprecedented powers in all parts of the UK. And as we go forward, we have to make sure that we fight to defend our fundamental civil rights and human rights in this country. This is not the first time that I have spoken in a parliament, but it is the first time that I'm speaking in a debate where a leader of the Labour Party has appointed me as a front bench spokesperson. So I thank Anna Sawar for offering me a role in the justice team. I'm particularly delighted to be working with Pauline McNeill, and I hope Pauline doesn't mind me saying this, but we've known each other since 1985. So I'm very well aware of her campaigning on many issues. I first met Pauline McNeill just after the miners' strike, And I strongly welcome the independent review of the convictions of minors that took place, of the convictions that took place during that strike, fought for by Neil Finlay, the NUM, and Thompson solicitors. And I would strongly urge the government to legislate in the first year of this parliament for the pardon scheme that has been proposed. The COVID pandemic has, of course, had a massive impact on the justice system. There is a huge backlog in civil and criminal cases, which has denied justice to victims, survivors and accused. SAGE has recognised that prisons are a high-risk environment for COVID and have recommended the universal vaccination of prison staff and prisoners. And I would ask that the government look at what the Prison Officers Association are saying and make vaccinations priorities in prisons. All my experience in the justice system has told me what a highly political arena it is. It is often suggested that justice is impartial and is applied without regard to wealth, power or status. But the reality is that the justice system is often dealing with some of the poorest in society, and class as a major issue. We need to look at who ends up behind bars and why. Most are male, and male violence is a major issue in offending, and most offenders come from very deprived communities. But the reality is the victims of crime also mainly come from working class communities. So I look forward in the coming period to working constructively across this chamber to solutions to long-standing and often difficult challenges about how we prevent crime, how we ensure all in society have justice, and how we deliver the kind of society that means that crime is something we do not need to fear. Thank you.
Thank you. I call James Dornan to be followed by Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak in today's debate on the recovery, renewal and transformation of justice post-pandemic. I'd like to add my colleagues' impassioned words on justice with a few observations of my own. I want to acknowledge the Scottish Police for their work throughout this pandemic. All of us here in this chamber have had the luxury of working from home, and their courage and commitment to providing peace and security during this grim year has not gone unnoticed. Sometimes under the most extreme of circumstances, we will forever be indebted to them. However, Presiding Officer, just because it feels that the world was put on hold does not mean the pursuit of justice and an equal and fair society should be was put on hold. There still exists an institutional injustice within Scottish society that's continued to flaunt and flourish during the pandemic. We were all witnesses to the disgraceful scenes in Glasgow this spring when a quote-unquote small minority of Rangers fans took over George Square, costing the city a significant amount of money, reputational damage and dignity. Presiding Officer, I won't delve into this too much as I've already done so in this chamber, but what I will say is that although these incidents would have been out with the scope of my initial draft member's bill, it's clear that the background to these riots has kick-started another debate on strict liability. Maybe we're all used to the chaos and vitriol which can surround football and we excuse this behaviour as a result. It's all just part of the game. But every country plays football, and not every country has to deal with this. And we, as Scots, must be better. We are better than this. Quite rightly, the Scottish Government is committed to a multitude of radical steps which can transform our justice system after the pandemic, most notably through the consultation on the removal of the not proven verdict. Therefore, innovative steps like the introduction of strict liability should be kept on the table too. Presiding Officer, I have a great deal of sympathy for both Polly McNeill's and Maggie Chapman's amendments and support any protection for women and the BAME community. I also recognise that the Scottish Government has a strong record in challenging racism and funding initiatives to combat it, whilst always also working with third sector organisations that include our diverse minority communities in Scotland. I welcome the commitment in the SNP manifesto to create a new programme of anti-racist education in schools modelled after a successful Thai campaign. We all know that education is the key to stamping out hatred, and I applaud the Scottish Government for investing over £15 million to support anti-sectarian education in our schools and workplaces. Yet, by its absence from the face of the Greens amendment or anywhere else in this debate, it appears clear that there still exists what seems to be the last acceptable form of racism here in Scotland. Catholics make up at least 16% of our population, and just over 5% of our non-British-born population have come here from Ireland to live and work as Scots. They are a sizeable, but to many still an invisible minority, one that is also victim to institutional prejudice within Scotland. And this is not just an issue for Glasgow, of course. Presiding officer, to my knowledge, no one has questioned Lothian Bus's decision to cancel the evening buses on the 17th of March. Now, Edinburgh, our second largest city and our capital, was still in level 3 lockdown on St Patrick's Day. Lothian Bus's restricted travel for what could only be essential workers commuting on a Tuesday evening. They briefly mentioned a rise in antisocial behaviour as a reason. This was the only day that action took place. Now, I can only assume that Lothian Buses concluded it was one of two things. That I'd be out celebrating my birthday, or that Irish Catholics were to blame for this rise in antisocial behaviour. Why else cancel buses only for the night of a ubiquitous Irish Catholic holiday when pubs were not open and there was a stay-at-home order in place? Can you imagine if this had happened round about the 12th of July, or if it happened round about a Muslim festival or a Sikh festival? It just is not acceptable. 2 months later, almost to the day, Rangers fans were given what appeared to many as a de facto licence to gather by the thousands in George Square, with even an off-duty police officer or two joining the revel. Our largest city looked like a war zone. Police officers were attacked. Anti-Irish racism and anti-Catholic bigotry was clearly heard being chanted and sung, with even reports of Rangers FC staff and players singing such vile nonsense. When I saw this video, I contacted Police Scotland, only to initially receive a vague and dismissive response. However, I'm happy to report that after explaining the importance of a fuller response, I'm content that Police Scotland had a thorough investigation, including an electronic investigation, and the video was, as I had always hoped, a fake. The people who post these things do not help in our fight for fairness and equality. Presiding officer, we have a chance to recover our dignity, renew our commitments to a multicultural Scotland, and transform how justice handles bigotry and inequalities post-pandemic. And I look forward to hearing more in due course of the efforts this Scottish Government will make this parliamentary term to tackle anti-Catholic bigotry, anti-Irish racism and all other prejudices. And I'd like to wish the new Cabinet Secretary well in his role and have no doubt that he will build upon the good work of his predecessor. Thanks to the SNP governments, there are now over 1,000 more police officers in Scotland than when we came to office, although you wouldn't believe that if you'd listened to some of the earlier speeches. And crime, including violent crime, has fallen over the last decade. Presiding officer, reform to justice was key to our manifesto, and this SNP government has a renewed and overwhelming mandate from the Scottish people to transform the justice system for the better and to keep our communities safer. We've already made Scotland a safer place, but we can, we must, and we will do more. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Alexander Stewart to be followed by Audrey Nicholl.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and may I welcome the Cabinet Secretary to his new post and congratulate Katie Clark on her maiden speech. I am delighted to be able to participate in this afternoon's debate on the recovery, renewal and transformation of Scotland's justice system. As was the case across the society, COVID-19 pandemic and the necessary restrictions have allowed and ensured that nothing more has changed, and there have been severe challenges across our justice system in Scotland. And it's incumbent on us in this Parliament, Presiding Officer, to work to ensure that our streets are safe. For those who break the social contract, they should be punished. And we are here to protect the rights of the victims. And that we need to do in a timely, effective and efficient manner. The most pressing concern facing the criminal justice system in Scotland is our court backlog. Whilst I would acknowledge there has been some innovation, and the Cabinet Secretary touched on that earlier, with cinemas as remote jury centres, there is still a lot to do to ensure that we get the backlog sorted. We have seen that criminal courts, the backlog has doubled within the last year, and we've been told by the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service that we will not get back to levels until March 2025. Justice of the Peace Courts only started this week to resume, and they have a lot to manage as well. So we need to be much more conceptive about how we manage the Scottish Government and how it tackles the backlog of that. As someone who served on the Joint Police Board for Tayside for 15 years, I have been saddened by some of the new developments in recent years since the SNP's merger with local police forces. Constituents have raised with me that they have real concerns about the loss of community policing within their area. But the fact is that fewer officers on the streets who are now having to work over much larger geographical areas is what is happening in our society. And we need to ensure that we restore more bobbies on the beat, Cabinet Secretary. That is important. Certainly.
Keith Brown.
Can I thank the member for taking the intervention? Would he acknowledge the fact that there are, on average, around a third more police officers as a percentage of the population in Scotland than in England and Wales, and also that they are paid at a higher rate, and that we've invested substantially in terms of the police, unlike the Conservative government in England?
Alexander Stewart.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. You indicate that we have a disproportion here in England compared to Scotland. No, I am sorry, Cabinet Secretary. There have been 739 lost police officers in Scotland. That is not the case south of the border. We are investing in ensuring that takes place. As also the police are properly resourced, we have talked about this in the past. Police Scotland requested nearly £86 million worth of capital funding, and that has not been fulfilled. The SNP have only given £50 million. And what we have seen in recent years is shocking stories about the state of our local police stations. This is totally unacceptable, Presiding Officer, and we must support and ensure that our officers and their support staff are working in conditions that are not falling apart, that roofs are not coming in, that water is not coming down walls. That is not acceptable. So also we have to talk about the loss of over 100 police stations across Scotland, and that makes the majority of constituents feel that there is an increasingly remoteness that the police have with the public sector. It is clear that we are, have seen that the Scottish Government will not review fundamentally the policy of Police Scotland. That we have seen that over the last session, and I would ensure that that will probably be the same over this session. There, however, has been opportunities for us to discuss and move things forward. We in the Scottish Conservatives would like to see the reinstatement of local police scrutiny boards across Scotland that would allow for greater input into policing decisions and how they are affected. I would also like to ask the Cabinet Secretary to consider carefully any measures that might address these problems. There are also some worrying signs that the SNP are failing to actually tackle the crime and the justice system. We have seen that just over half of violent criminals going into prison of the SNP's presumption against short-term prison sentences. And that we have seen violent crime increase from 8,080 cases in 2018-19 to 9,316 in 2019-20. As one of these questions we have to ask about, is the government really on the side of the victims? In this vein, I would ask that we add our support, and I do add my support to the comments that Jamie Green made in his opening address, to ensure that we do enhance the rights of victims. Too often in debates within this chamber, victims' interests are treated as an afterthought. It is wrong that we would, and we have to change that mindset. What is needed is that we ensure that we understand the effects of crime. That is why the decision for the SNP to reduce the budgets of victims and witnesses' support by £500,000 is truly staggering. I would also encourage the new Cabinet Secretary to look again at that cut and effect for the victims. It's very important that victims are looked upon. It's vitally important the opportunities are seen and ensure that victims have statements during court proceedings and at parole hearings. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, we in the Scottish Conservatives are committed to ensuring that Scotland's communities are safe. Before the pandemic, violent crime was already on the rise. There was a growing sense that Scotland had the criminal justice system did not protect the victims, and that policing felt that they were distant and more remote within their communities. The pandemic has helped to ensure that this situation has been exacerbated, and that needs to be managed. I look forward to working with the government where we can find common ground, but also to hold them to account where their performance is below what Scots would expect of their government and their police force. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Audrey Nicholl to be followed by Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Over the last few weeks, this chamber has facilitated a number of important recovery debates, on issues including health, our economy, education, tackling poverty and, of course, COVID-19. This afternoon, we are debating justice, the golden thread that, in my mind, ties these and other issues together, the cog in the wheel of our well-being, our livelihoods, an economy and our future prosperity. The global pandemic impacted numerous functions within the justice system. However, the sector could not simply transition to essential business only. Front-facing services had to continue, justice staff protected, and new potentially life-saving COVID legislation used to protect our wider society. Police officers had to balance an education approach when engaging with the public with enforcing the law. Prison and healthcare staff had to manage COVID-19 and prevent its spread within the confinements of our prison estate. And court staff had the huge challenge of reconfiguring court processes so they could operate effectively and safely. Today, I wish to pay tribute to everyone across all justice agencies and on the front line for their commitment to ensuring justice processes adapted and responded to the constraints that COVID-19 placed upon them. Presiding Officer, last week I made my first speech as a newly elected MSP in the health recovery debate, and I spoke about the growing intersect between policing and public health. In support of this wide-ranging motion today, and based on my own experience in policing, I would like to return to this theme, which I believe directly impacts both on our court system and our prison population. The Justice Vision and Priorities Delivery Report, published back in March, provided an update on the progress made in delivering on priorities set in 2017 for justice organisations and partners, and they included improving health and well-being in justice settings, focusing on mental health and substance misuse. The report highlighted the progress made towards increasing the number of mental health workers across Scotland, including in justice settings. And I am pleased that this is now underway and that health professionals are now working in some, but not all, police custody settings. We know the devastating impact of COVID-19 on our mental health, regardless of our background or experiences. We also know people in contact with the criminal justice system have higher levels of mental ill health than the general population and generally live in communities that face social and economic disadvantage. We also know the incidence of police interacting with people with poor mental health increased during the pandemic, and inevitably some were taken into custody. This is at odds with a range of legislation, operating procedures and protocols around place of safety, not least of all the Mental Health Care and Treatment Act, that specifically states a police station should not be used as a place of safety unless there is no suitable alternative available. Entering custody, especially for the first time, can be traumatic, particularly where the pathway there was not connected to offending. Rather, it was the result of someone's circumstances and experience. In situations such as this, rather than making someone who is already at a low point even more vulnerable, entering police custody should offer an opportunity for health and other professionals to connect with individuals who often do not traditionally engage with health and other services. I'm aware of the work being developed by the Scottish Government, Police Care Network, NHS, Police Scotland, and others to take this important priority forward, and I am pleased some aspects gained added traction during the pandemic, and I very much hope that the new Cabinet Secretary for Justice will support this transformational work and the innovative opportunities that exist to improve and develop nurse-led models of care, custody exit processes and pathways to support, and perhaps just as importantly, pathways into care and support that actually circumvent police custody in the first place. But perhaps that's a debate for another day. Presiding Officer, policing in Scotland has evolved in recent years, prioritising keeping people safe, protecting victims' rights and dealing effectively with offenders while upholding the fundamental human rights of everyone coming into contact with the service. The fact remains, however, that a population of people continue to enter custody having committed no crime or offence, frequently experiencing poor mental health, essentially criminalised by a system that exists to protect them. Presiding Officer, as the justice sector moves through the pandemic, there is no doubt there will be challenges ahead, but there will also be transformative opportunities to place policing on a contemporary, to place Scotland on a contemporary and innovative footing in respect of custody provision, developing a truly person-led approach that has trauma-informed care, dignity and compassion at its heart. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Faisal Chowdhury to be followed by Christine Graham. This is Mr. Chowdhury's first speech in the chamber.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I hope you'll be kind to me. I stand in support of Labour amendments in the name of Pauline McNeill. I would like to begin by expressing how humbled and honoured I am to be serving as a newly elected member of the Scottish Parliament. As is only right, I show my appreciation to the people of the Lothian region who have helped me to get here, and I promise to work hard to repay this debt of gratitude on their behalf. My mother and I moved to the UK from Bangladesh in 1982. We moved to join my dad to build a better life for our family, settling initially in Manchester before moving to Edinburgh, a city I'm proud of to have called home for nearly 40 years, a city where I have put down my roots and raising my family, a city where I can as proud to say I'm a member of ethnic minority community as I can say I'm a Scottish and British. Over the years, I've built on my father's legacy, working hard to establish thriving and successful business, giving opportunities for employment in the city, and I will draw on my business background to help inform my work as an MSP. My late father and my uncles took the opportunities available and became pillars of the community, and as they were helped, they have helped those gain footholds by establishing and running orphanage abroad and setting up charities at home. I was taught from an early age to help those who need a hand to support and develop local communities. These are the values I gained from my parents, and these are the values I live by. I've been involved with Edinburgh and Lothian Regional Equality Council for over 20 years, chairing it for 11 years. I have been advocating for equality and justice my entire adult life, not just for people from minority ethnic communities, but for people disadvantaged economically. People outside this area think of Edinburgh as a rich city in a rich country. This belief hides the fact that some of our people are forced to live in inadequate housing, suffering from the injustice of poverty, and the quality of their lives are reduced as a result. It's a shameful truth that people in the most deprived areas of the city often die years before others who live in more affluent areas. The COVID pandemic, with which we are still struggling, has highlighted poverty in our country. The impact on some areas and communities has angered many. I have witnessed this hardship firsthand when delivering food parcels to those who have been hit hard by this tragedy. It is not possible to exaggerate the seriousness of the situation that I have witnessed. I understand their suffering, having lost a close member of my own family during the pandemic. We debate justice this afternoon. During COVID-19, as a chair of LREC, I was aware of an increase in contacts from BME community who had experienced being racially abused, both physically and verbally, but felt let down by the police and other agencies. In order to thrive, our local communities must feel safe and free from the fear of crime. Many of us still have concerns following the centralization of police service with creation of Police Scotland. Following COVID-19, we need to restore connection between the policing and local people, building trust and ensuring community feel safe to come forward. We must also ensure that action will be taken with other agencies working together. Our communities need police force that is from them and for them. As a member of the BME community, I have experienced discrimination and how cruel it can be, leading to feeling of isolation. I will use my position to speak up for those who are not adequately represented. With that, I recognize the privilege of being elected as the first Bangladeshi-born Muslim MSP, just as their other first have done before me, and those elected at the same time as me. I hope to make my own contribution and will work to improve civic and political engagement amongst all minority groups, because this will serve to enrich and strengthen the lives of our people. The Parliament must truly be a Parliament for all the people of Scotland. I am of the view that education plays an essential role in rooting out discrimination and making for a fairer and more just society. For example, the school curriculum should recognize historic injustice, and this should be taught truthfully. As legislator, we have a special opportunity to ensure that our young people understand the truth of our country's history, including that a significant part of its wealth was built on the exploitation of people of color across the globe. I was pleased to learn last week that the Welsh Parliament had passed legislation to integrate BME history in the curriculum. Why can't we deliver the same in Scotland? I'm delighted to have been appointed by Anas as a Shadow Minister for Culture, Europe and International Development. I look forward to working with Sarah as a long-standing friend and comrade. Finally, I would like to pay tribute to my predecessor, Neil Findlay, whose vigorous campaigning so enlivened debates in this chamber. He worked with so many community organizations, for example, on issues such as vaginal mesh scandal. His pioneering work with trade union and the treatment of the striking miners. We will not forget his intervention of the terrible, sad consequence of discharging COVID-positive people into care homes. I wish Neil well for the future and promise that I will continue his work helping people who suffer injustice. My promise to Lothian people is that I will contribute to Scottish Labour's effort in restoring public trust and confidence in our political institutions so that together we can foster a more diverse, inclusive and tolerant society. And every day I will bring a voice to those who feel they are not heard in this place. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Christine Graham to be followed by Edward Mountain.
Thank you very much, Deputy President. Of good speech, Mr. Chowdhury. I think I wouldn't just have used the word enlivened of Neil Findlay, but there you go. I think what I'm interested in this, and I want to focus on civil business, because most of the debate, quite rightly here, has been about the criminal process in court. But for most people, for the public, most of the interaction they have with the court process is in the civil courts, whether it's to contribute in a contractual dispute, delictual action, matrimonial disputes, divorce, contact, residency, confirmation of an executory, interdicts, and so on, and of course in our commercial courts. Now, already much in the process has been simplified, which I welcome. I welcome the fact that we're moving to more online work, and this will reduce costs, as will electronic transfer of documents. But delays in court business, the impacts, of course, on civil business matters as much to the individuals involved, whether they're pursuer or defender, as it does in criminal proceedings. And, of course, in the Sheriff Court, criminal proceedings must take precedence, quite rightly, because custody is involved and loss of liberty and a criminal record. But to, as I say, to the pursuer or the defender in a civil case, to them it's urgent. Now, even impartially, some are, of course, urgent to anyone. For instance, interim interdicts against a really bad neighbour, against something that's going on, then you need that pretty quick. interim orders in relation to children, particularly young children, because if a parent or carer doesn't get to see a child for a while, the whole relationship can disappear into the mists. Exclusion orders. Now, we've talked about abuse in domestic abuse in the criminal setting, but in the civil setting, exclusion orders to prevent an abusive partner getting into the home and so on are all important. And in passing, can I say to Pauline McNeill, I'm sympathetic to domestic abuse courts, actually specialist courts, specialist sheriffs and family law and so on, do exist, and it's very important they take an interest in it, just as we have specialist sheriffs and judges in commercial actions. I want to turn to commercial cases. It maybe doesn't sound like something we should be bothering about in the court of session, but it is. These two often require timorous action, and indeed, the pursuer may have a choice of which jurisdiction to bring a very substantial court case. And if they're going to choose Scotland to bring that case, large commercial case with legal ramifications, large amount of money involved, then they want to know that it's going to progress timorously. And if it doesn't progress timorously, they may take that court case somewhere else, to another jurisdiction. So there's ramifications for our senior courts in progressing high cases timorously and, of course, in pursuing and progressing Scots law. And it's important maintaining the status of Scots law. Now, there was a reference somewhere to mediation. I don't know where we are with this, but it seems like decades ago when I chaired the Justice Committee, I went to Baltimore with a whole lot of highfalutin justice people to look at the way mediation operated there. Mediation there was not just in family cases. It was in large commercial cases. Because the pursuer and the defender, these big guys who are in these cases, they knew at the end of the day there had to be a resolution. And better to get it done in mediation than all the ramifications of huge expenses. Because as we know, when you're in court, you may get judicial expenses, but you will not get all your expenses. And I make a clear distinction between mediation and arbitration. Arbitration, of course, is when a decision is made by the arbiter. Mediation is where the parties engaged in dispute come to a mutual agreement. I would like to see that pursued. And again, I think there are ramifications here, not just in our matrimonial cases and family law cases for this, but in commercial cases, when you might get disputes brought to Scotland if you have a very robust mediation service in operation. And I don't know where that's got to. Perhaps the Cabinet Secretary can tell me over the years how that's developed. I think it's sometimes like pushing a great big rock up a hill and it coming rolling back quite often to land on your toes. Turning now to civil legal aid. Now, I appreciate funding is not a bottomless pit, Cabinet Secretary, and I do appreciate that the criminal legal aid system again has to take priority. The funding must go there because, again, we're talking about a criminal conviction, possible criminal conviction, and loss of liberty. So I do understand that. However, is there a potential for savings if we are using these more efficacious ways of progressing civil court cases, online, electronic transfer, all of which used to cost money in court process and in documentation? Is there any way that we could actually, with better funding to civil legal aid system, for example, raising the bar on the earnings you have or on the capital you have? Because if you're very poor, you can use the civil legal aid system. If you're very rich, you can afford to go to court. But a lot of people are jam-packed in the middle. And there is a decision there about whether they go to court because their contribution might be very high. They might even be excluded from having legal aid. And justice should not depend on the depth of your pockets. So, I'll be brief. Oh, I'm not that brief. I'm only 5 minutes. While I understand the majority are focused on criminal matters, I do think it's important to shift the balance. And remember, for most people out there, it's in the civil courts. Thank you. It's in the civil courts that justice is where they meet it. Thank you very much, Mr. Mountain. I know you borrowed it from me, but the pen gesture is not necessary. I conclude.
Thank you, Ms. Graham, and I now call Edward Mountain.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to congratulate those members of Parliament who gave their maiden speeches this afternoon and for the insight they have brought to the Parliament. Justice is, of course, the cornerstone of all democracies, and COVID-19 has definitely challenged the timely delivery of justice. We've seen the criminal court backlog more than double in size, leaving many feeling without meaningful access to justice. Now, while I welcome the use of digital courts to reduce the backlog and their use in hearings, these solutions are predicated on having good broadband, something that we can't take for granted across Scotland and especially in the Highlands. Now, reducing this backlog needs to be a top priority for the Cabinet Secretary, but he will be also facing a number of other pressures which don't purely come as a result of the pandemic. It is clear his predecessor left him with an overflowing in-tray of problems. Fewer frontline police officers since 2013, record numbers of criminals flouting electronic tag sentences, and long delays to the delivery of new modern prisons. It's a sorry state of affairs, and it highlights how much a soft touch to justice has not been working for Scotland. Moving forward, I think the Cabinet Secretary needs to try a new approach, tackling problems head-on. And in doing so, we must restore local policing, put victims first, and ensure that our communities are kept safe. If he does this, I will happily support his ideas. But most of all, Scotland needs a Justice Secretary that delivers on the promises his party makes. In the Highlands and Islands, we have now waited over a decade for the promised new prison to be built in Inverness. 10 years of broken promises, which are costing taxpayers more and more money. Back in 2011, I'm sure the Cabinet Secretary will know, the SNP government promised to build a new prison which would cost £52 million. They failed to deliver. Then in 2016, the SNP made another promise to build the new prison again at a cost of £66 million. And they broke that promise too. This year they've made another promise to build the very same prison again by 2024, at a cost of £110 million. So my question, Cabinet Secretary, to you is, will we be third time lucky, or will there be a hat-trick of broken promises? This government cannot keep kicking the can down the road and make Highlanders wait for a modern prison, which is so desperately needed. By doing so, they are letting down our dedicated prison staff at HMP Inverness, who are working in a Victorian-era prison that I quote, is costly to run and no longer fit for purpose. That is the conclusion, Cabinet Secretary, of Scotland's Chief Inspector of Prisons, who's called for this government to expedite its replacement. And there's every reason for it to be fast-tracked. It's a shovel-ready project. The site's been purchased, planning permission confirmed, and let's not underestimate the importance of the many jobs that this project will create. So, Cabinet Secretary, if you want to intervene, I'll ask you the question now. Will you and can you step up to the plate and deliver on the three promises that your predecessors have singly failed to do? And a simple answer of yes or no will do for me.
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm very pleased to answer a question which I wasn't able to do in response to a previous Conservative member. The member will know the answer to that question if he's read our manifesto, and I would commend our manifesto, the one that won the election, to him if he wants to read that.
Edward Mountain.
Oh, well, there you go. There's no answer, no yes or no, no prison guaranteed. I would have loved to have heard it from his lips, but I haven't. So let me turn to another issue. I also believe it's time for the SNP government to launch its long overdue consultation on Scottish courts fees for the period 2021 to 2024. Hasn't been launched yet, it's overdue. And I hope that this consultation can pave the way to making access to justice fairer and less expensive. In particular, Cabinet Secretary, I believe we need to look at the setting up of annual fees for guardianships, which are essential to help the lives of those who are vulnerable or disabled. Currently, the fees are set by the value of the estate, meaning that those who have an estate value between £50,000 and £250,000 are forced to pay £600 a year to have their accounts assessed. Those with estates valued with more have to pay over £1,000 every year. And that could add up to thousands of pounds over the course of a guardianship. And it's questionable how justifiable this is, especially considering the guardian may also be the lifelong partner of the person who has to pay the fee.
These fees are, in my view, excessive. As one constituent explained to me, why should his wife pay a fee for him, for somebody to check his work that he does on her behalf? For me, this is frankly no more than a tax on the disabled and the vulnerable. Surely Scotland can do better than this. So perhaps it's time, Cabinet Secretary, to consider whether we should follow the system in England and Wales by having a much flatter fee structure. And I call on the Cabinet Secretary to include this as part of the consultation, which no doubt he will now undertake. Presiding Officer, an effective justice system requires fair and timely access for all. That's why this government must prioritise reducing the court backlog, fast-tracking the building of modern prisons, including our long-promised Highland Prison, and ensure guardianship fees are far more reasonable for her. I urge the Cabinet Secretary, as he settles into his new desk, to add both of these issues to his to-do list and not leave them in the cupboard for his successor to tackle. Thank you.
And I now call our last speaker in the open debate, Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to congratulate the Cabinet Secretary in his new role and the members across Chamber who have done their first speeches today. I welcome this debate and the Scottish Government's vision for a safe, just and resilient Scotland. This ambition will ensure that our justice services have the resources required to meet the challenges presented by the COVID-19 pandemic, and indeed to bring about lasting change and positive transformation as we move forward. I echo James Dornan's thanks to all our police officers throughout this pandemic who have worked tirelessly on the front line. Today, I'd like to focus my contribution on three key areas. These are around some of the lessons our justice system can learn from the pandemic, access to medications in custody settings, and on the arrangements surrounding youth remand and detention. Presiding Officer, firstly, I want to welcome the Government's commitment to additional £50 million in this year's budget to support recovery across the justice system. This includes the Court Recovery Programme, which will increase capacity in both the High Court and Sheriff Courts across Scotland. Indeed, I welcome the recommendation from the Lord Clark's Trial Working Group for the continuation of remote jury centres as the most effective solution to increase trial capacity and reduce delays for cases going to trial. This is an important change which could bring about a lasting impact by people not having to physically travel to attend jury service. This will also have an impact on emissions reduction, and as the debate yesterday said, tackling climate emergency does apply across all portfolios. Similarly, the option of people in Police Scotland custody suites attending court via video link is also welcome. Evidence has shown that this has reduced the stress and the cost of people in custody being physically transferred to a court, then to be detained until the court can hear the case. Such innovations are extremely positive, and I would hope to see them remain in place as the Government takes forward its review of Scotland's prosecution system. I have no doubt that these changes will work towards our aim of delivering a fairer, faster and more effective justice. However, I want to raise the issue with the Cabinet Secretary that jury trials in Dumfries and Stranraer Sheriff Courts have been moved to Ayr over the course of the pandemic. While the majority of jurors and those accused have been able to appear virtually, I ask for an assurance from the Cabinet Secretary that this arrangement will be considered in the Government's review and that those involved with the justice sector in Dumfries and Galloway will be able to feed in. Presiding Officer, as our justice system moves into the future, there is room to explore better health arrangements and for access to medications and indeed medical technologies in custody and detention centres. I recently contacted Police Scotland and the Scottish Prison Service to seek further information on the current policies relating to medication. I found that in Scotland, the management of medication for a person in custody is the responsibility of a healthcare professional, and that an assessment of a person's needs and vulnerabilities is carried out upon the arrival at the police station by the health professional. However, there is no set time for when a person in police custody or a prison setting must be seen by a healthcare professional. So an example would be if a person arrested is wearing medical technology such as continuous blood glucose monitor or insulin pump for diabetes management, the devices will have to be removed when entering a cell. Now, as a person with type 1 diabetes myself, even 1 hour without my insulin pump can cause serious hyperglycemia, and that's a health emergency. Equally, both Police Scotland and the Scottish Prison Service have medication classed as either urgent or non-urgent. Some examples of non-urgent medicine include anti-anxiety medicine. I had a constituency case where a young person was not able to access his anti-anxiety meds in custody, which caused much stress and frustration and, of course, increased anxiety. Given this and the opportunity we have to transform our current policies, I would ask the Cabinet Secretary whether he would be open to exploring these issues so that we can further look at how we can improve the experiences and well-being of those in custody. The last issue I want to raise is around youth remand in Scotland. Previously, I had another case where a young man was held on remand at HMYOY Polmont. Because this young man was on remand, which can last for anything up to 140 days, he was unable to access any of the organised events and activities within HMP Polmont, and he was kept in a separate wing with 21 hours of isolation each day, with only 3 family visits each week. Given the government's commitment to implementing the Barnahus or Bairnshus model, which is a multidisciplinary or interagency approach for dealing with young people going through the justice system, I would ask the Cabinet Secretary to prioritise youth remand and implement Barnahus, as he mentioned earlier. My constituents and I would be happy to help feed into this process. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government's firm focus on community safety, crime prevention and the rehabilitation of offenders has meant less crime and fewer victims than a decade ago. Maybe this will help answer one of Pam Gosell's questions. And Alexander Stewart, you can't just quote 1 year of figures. That's no a trend. The Scottish Crime and Justice Survey 2019-20 that captures incidents not reported to the police, as well as those which are, shows crime in Scotland has fallen by 46% since 2008 and 2009, with violent crime down by almost 2/5. I used to live in Los Angeles, presiding. I'm in my last.
The member's just about
seconds
to conclude. Thank
I
you.
Used to live in Los Angeles, presiding officer, and that actually is somewhere you might worry about being safe. But this shows that the SNP and the reduction of violent crime, the SNP's approach to justice is working. And in closing, I again welcome this debate and the steps being taken to improve our justice system for all. Thank you.
Thank you. And I now move to closing speeches. I would advise we are tight for time and I would ask members to stick to their limit. And I would point out that we're missing one member who spoke in the debate, and it is a courtesy to be in for closing speeches. I call Liam MacArthur to wind up for the Lib Dems. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by congratulating Faisal Chowdhury on his first speech? I think this Parliament will benefit from his insights and experience, and his constituents will benefit from the passion with which he represents them. With my Deputy Presiding Officer hat on, though, I would discourage him from taking on the mantle of his predecessor when it comes to points of order. Could I also congratulate Katie Clark on her first speech? I think she and Pauline McNeill are going to be a formidable double act on the justice brief, which has been grotesquely gender imbalanced over the course of the last Parliament. So I very much welcome them both to their posts. And again, can I thank the Cabinet Secretary, like others have, for the early engagement he had with myself and other justice spokespeople, following on, to be fair, a trend that his predecessor was very committed to. The motion we've been considering today is about the recovery, the renewal and the transformation of our justice system, and I don't think anybody would disagree with the appropriateness of that. COVID has had a massive impact, albeit that many of these issues, as I said, predate the pandemic. And I also acknowledge that I think the very important point that Christine Graham made about the impact it's had on the civil justice system as well as the criminal justice system. That said, I think we've seen innovation over the course of the last 15 months, which is very much to be welcomed, whether it's in terms of the way in which our courts have been able to transform and operate remotely, the rollout of electronic monitoring of bail, and indeed, I would have to say, the provision of phones for prisoners in order to maintain contact with family members, which has to be a step in the right direction in terms of maintaining the contact that allow the rehabilitation, the reintegration into the community to take place more successfully. Maggie Chapman talked about the power imbalance in our justice system, and I think the questions we've heard around the legal aid system go to very much to the heart of that. I recognise there have been moves in the right direction over recent months, but much more is needed. I would argue that there are risks, real risks, of legal aid deserts in certain parts of the country, not least in the parts of the country that I represent. And I think Jamie Green was right to quote, a system that is creaking at the seams. Much of Jamie Green's contribution focused, as his amendment does, on the issue of victims. And while I'm not in a position to support his amendment, I think I would very much commend the characteristically constructive way in which he put across his argument. Of course, in relation to victims, I think Holly McNeill, Katie Clark, Rona Mackay and others focus very much on the impact of crime on women. I think anybody that's listened to Miss M, to Speak Out Survivors and others campaigning, you cannot fail to be, I think, impressed and indeed persuaded that the argument for change in this area, not just in terms of not proven, the issue around corroboration as well, needs to be addressed seriously. And I think there is now a commitment across the Chamber to do just that. I think I'd welcome, too, the moves in relation to providing anonymity for victims of sexual offences, which is in place south of the border, but I think is a lacuna in the Scottish system. I would also argue that there, I think, needs to be more safeguards for the way in which victims of sexual offences are interrogated within court. And finally, on this point, I think I would welcome the work and commend the work of Dame Helena Kennedy in looking at a standalone misogyny offence, but I think that will be limited in what it can do. And I would, I think, again, commend to the Cabinet Secretary, as I did to his predecessor, the idea of my colleague Karen Lindsay for a commission to look at the wider issues of violence against women, because I think this goes far more broadly than just the standalone offence on misogyny. In this debate, we've also heard much talk about the impact on police, and again, like others, I would pay tribute to the role that they've played, particularly over the course of the last 15 months. Liam Kerr made an intervention following on from FMQs earlier on today about the use of body-worn cameras, and I think while a rights-based approach needs to be taken to that, I think all the evidence suggests there are benefits to be gained in terms of early pleas, resolution of cases and easing some of the burden on our court services. But we ask our police to do difficult, often dangerous jobs on our behalf, and it's only right that we then provide them with the resources, both in terms of the buildings that they're based in, the equipment that they have, to do that job. And I think there are particular concerns around the lack of support in relation to their IT capital budget, which is absolutely essential for them in terms of matching the sorts of crimes that they're being asked to deal with. It's a point the SPA and Police Scotland have been making. Let me conclude on the issue of prison reform. I said earlier that we have a shameful level of incarceration in this country. It's far higher than anywhere else in the UK. Indeed, it's far higher than anywhere else in Europe, save for Russia and Turkey. The remand population is particularly alarming in that context. I think there are specific concerns about the way it engages with women, many of whom themselves are the victims of crime. And I think, again, I would applaud Audrey Nicholl for reminding us of the linkage between the criminal justice system and health, particularly mental health. I think we need to properly fund the robust community-based measures that are far more effective in dealing with many of these issues. We need through care and support back into the community that help the individuals, but also help to make our communities safer. Finally, can I just make mention of points made by Michelle Thompson in relation to the Peter Cherby petition and the Esther Robertson review, both on the finished business for the Justice Committee in the last session, and likewise Rona Mackay on the Barna House, which again is getting underway, and I look forward to supporting those efforts, as I do many of the other points that have been made in this debate. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr MacArthur. I now call on Maggie Chapman to wind up for the Greens. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I would like to thank the Cabinet Secretary, and I should have done this in my opening remarks, for your contribution this afternoon and the constructive discussions we have already had about how we progress priorities in this important area of the coming parliamentary term. I share his vision of a faster, fairer and more effective justice system. And while I'm sure there will be much we disagree on, particularly perhaps the focus of and approach to how we deliver this, I'm pleased to hear his commitment to restorative justice, mediation and arbitration, and genuinely trauma-informed services. Never again should a survivor of rape be told by a police officer that, and I quote, the sex might have got rough. It doesn't mean you had to enjoy it. And I welcome, too, the constructive approach taken by Jamie Green, almost uniquely, perhaps, from that side of the chamber. For there to be any agreement between Greens and Conservatives on justice issues is quite something. Surely this will be the parliamentary term in which we abolish the not proven verdict. I look forward to future conversations with Pauline McNeill, Katie Clark and Liam MacArthur and others in this chamber over the coming term on tackling gender-based violence, investment in communities, the overuse of remand, timely resolution to FAIs, improvements to legal aid and so much more. But I'm one of the new kids on the justice block. And sometimes fresh eyes on seemingly entrenched issues can help shift things in different directions. I am keen that we use the opportunities provided by the context of this debate at this time, recovery, renewal, and transformation, to consider what a justice system based on human rights and equalities really should look like. I alluded to this in my opening remarks, but I think it bears a little bit more focus. What the Netherlands has achieved in reforming their prison system is truly remarkable. They have closed more than half of their prisons, and yet they still cannot fill the ones they have. Their crime levels are such that they now import prisoners from other countries. They have achieved this by taking a mental health approach to justice. Rather than focus on punishment, the first response is care. Identifying what mental health interventions are needed by people who are accused of breaking the law and treating that first. Because we know that prisons, as they are currently set up here, increase reoffending. They are also where many offenders start a lifetime of dependency on drugs. We must change this. And there is a lot more I want to say about reforming our police system. Its accountability, its use of force, of surveillance, how it engages with communities, how it understands power inequalities and diversity. But these big issues will have to wait for another time. But there is work to do to ensure our police are genuinely part of and reflect the communities they seek to protect, and that they do understand the issues faced by different survivors and victims. If we do this work, if we make the transformations we need to see and shift resources into prevention work, education, social care, early intervention, and so on, we will, at last, I think, bring the recommendations of the Christie Commission into the justice system in a genuine way. And it will allow us to tackle some of the often overlooked crimes that damage our communities, corporate and environmental crime. Justice at all levels can only be achieved by a collaborative and inclusive approach in partnership and solidarity with civil society and local voices. And I look forward to working with colleagues in this chamber and those in third sector and other organisations across Scotland to deliver a justice system that is genuinely based on human rights and equalities. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. I now call on Rhoda Grant to wind up for Labour, up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I start by paying tribute to my colleagues, Katie Clark and Faisal Chowdhury, who made their first speeches in the Parliament today. And there were excellent speeches, really moving, and I think it reminds us all, while colleagues stepped down and retired at the last session and we thought we would miss them, and we do miss them very much. We see new people coming forward with fresh ideas, new perspectives, and feeding them in. And I think that renews the chamber and is good for us all. So I'm really pleased that they're here, and it was delightful to listen to their contributions to this debate. Can I also pay tribute to police and indeed all emergency workers, police officers, and all those that were on the front line during the COVID pandemic? Police and emergency workers, prison officers, had to face the dangers of the pandemic. They couldn't keep themselves safe and did that on our behalf. And I think we should all be grateful to them. Our amendment focuses very much on violence against women. And I want to start with that because we all know that inequality leads to violence against women. And we need a society to deal with that inequality. And despite justice interventions, violence against women continues to grow. Our whole justice system is geared towards keeping citizens safe, yet women are expected to protect themselves from predatory males. And if they fail to do that, our justice system apportions blame towards them, rather than holding the attacker totally responsible. And that was a point Pauline McNeill made when she talked about the tragic case of Sarah Everard. One of the things that was pointed out to us all when she went missing was that she was walking home late at night, as if she shouldn't be out late at night. And Pauline made the point that women shouldn't be forced to stay home at night just because men are unable to behave themselves properly and leave women alone. And the public outcry to that, I think, was rightly loud. And even in the situation of a pandemic, women gathered to take back the streets. And while I would never encourage anyone to take risks during a pandemic, I absolutely understood what they were trying to do. And we need to join forces, not just the women in this chamber, but the men as well, to make sure that those voices are heard and we change our whole society's outlook towards violence against women. We saw as well during the pandemic that domestic abuse continued to increase, a 5.7% higher last year than in 15-16. And that emphasised the distance from and access to services that was initially a huge problem for domestic abuse services while keeping their own staff safe, trying to support those who needed their support. The Robert Gordon University looked at the North East and Orkney, and they actually pointed out that telephone services were really helpful in this respect because they could have someone available at any point at the end of a phone, and we need to look at the lessons that were learned and make sure that we carry them forward. Katie Clark talked about domestic abuse courts and the need for them to be in place, and this is something I have pushed for a long period of time. They work well where they are, but we need them all over Scotland. Just because you live in a rural area, you should not...
Jamie Green.
I do appreciate Ms Grant taking intervention. She raises some very grave and valid points, which I totally agree with. But I just wanted to clarify Labour's position on the establishment of these new courts, further to Lady Dorrien's recommendations. Is it the case that Labour's position is that whatever happens in these courts, we will still protect the sanctity and importance of trial by jury, and there will be no watering down of the justice system as those accused go through that system? In that case, we'd be minded to support your amendment, if that can be clarified.
Rhoda Grant.
Those courts need to be robust. It is about understanding the nature of domestic abuse and violence against women. We want to see those in those courts that lead those cases, that lead defence, lead the prosecution of those cases to have an understanding. Far too often, a woman is blamed for the abuse she suffers at the hands of the courts. Of course we need juries, but we need juries that are led and made to understand the nature of domestic abuse. I have teachers and social workers who do not understand the nature of domestic abuse when I'm dealing with constituents. So people picked up from the street, as you do with a jury, have the same issues. They need to be led and guided by the professionals in those courts to make sure that they do that properly and offer the protection. We just see the very low conviction rates for domestic abuse and sexual abuse that comes from our courts. We need to do something about it. We can't continue the way we are. We need those specialist courts in place. We also need to tackle commercial sexual exploitation, which actually underlines the inequality, the perception that men can access women and that women are available and for sale in our country. It's simply wrong. We need to change the position of women in our society, make them truly equal to actually tackle violence against women. And we need to hold the men accountable because it's not a woman's problem, it's a men's problem. So we need to make sure that they are held to account. And Maggie Chapman, in her opening speech, made that point, but she carried it further into how abuse of power can really be difficult in our society and that we need to deal with it. Presiding Officer, I had wanted to touch on an awful lot of the other aspects of this debate because I think it was really important, but I'm noticing I'm already running out of time. Can I just highlight and maybe take the moment to highlight a local issue? Edward Mountain talked about Inverness Prison. We have an ancient prison in Inverness. It has been subject to COVID outbreaks because you can't distance and you can't treat prisoners properly. We desperately need that now. We also need a prison facility that is fit for women. Women have to go to HMV MP Grampian and HMP Cortonvale, miles away from their families, and that simply is not right. We need a justice system that is there to protect and prevent and to rehabilitate. It must change and renew to provide the protection in an ever-changing world. And we must provide the same protection to all, regardless of their gender and indeed their ethnicity. We must all be equal before the law, and therefore we must all be equally protected by the law.
Thank you. I now call on Russell Finlay to wind up for the Conservatives. Up to 8 minutes, please. And this is Mr. Finlay's first speech to our Parliament.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. George Beattie is innocent. In 1973, the year I was born, George Beattie was convicted of murdering Margaret McLaughlin in Curlook. The BBC's Rough Justice programme later exposed serious concerns about his conviction. Last year, a new book identified a more likely suspect. This prompted Bob Alexander, Margaret's former fiancé, to break his 47-year silence to state George Beattie is innocent. He thought this miscarriage of justice would finally be put right. Nothing happened. We don't have time to rehearse all the evidence here today, but I say with confidence, George Beattie is innocent. I'm not the first politician to stand in a parliament and say so. The late Labour MP Jimmy Hood did just that in the House of Commons 28 years ago. Despite all this, George told me he expects to go to his grave as a wrongly convicted murderer. This case shames Scotland. But having spent decades working as a journalist, trying to shine a light on injustice, it does not surprise me. Willie Beck devoted his life fighting to overturn his 1981 conviction for armed robbery. Credible and independent people are certain of his innocence. Willie died suddenly last year. His family vow to keep up the fight. Some might say this is history. Society has changed. I would say in response, open your eyes. Injustice is rife in modern Scotland. It has a corrosive impact. Its effects are profound, often consuming lives or cutting them short. It does not just mean wrongful convictions. Take the family of Kevin MacLeod, who was found dead in Wick Harbour in 1997. For two decades, the authorities dismissed this young man's death as not suspicious, then admitted it should have been treated as murder. Or Emma Caldwell, who was murdered in 2005, as we've already heard so powerfully from Pauline McNeill. Detectives blindly pursued the wrong suspects when a much more likely perpetrator was right in front of them. Or Sheku Bayo, who died in police custody on a Fife Street 6 years ago, yet his loved ones still don't know what happened. Or the countless families who have suffered medical negligence, sometimes resulting in the loss of a loved one. While stricken with grief, they have to contend with a confusing and intimidating legal process. Then there are the former Rangers administrators, innocent men maliciously prosecuted by the Crown Office. This left taxpayers with a bill for unknown millions, yet the former Lord Advocate responsible today sits in the High Court bench dispensing justice. I have been inspired by the resilience, determination and dignity of many ordinary people plunged into the abyss of injustice. Among the first were the so-called Four Bampots of Milton in Glasgow. These brave local fathers objected when Labour politicians and the police handed control of their community centre to a drugs gang. They defiantly embraced the term Bampots, which the council had used to smear them. Labour defended the indefensible for years. The gang was only evicted when people started getting shot dead on Glasgow's streets. No one in authority was ever held to account for this perversion or for many other of these scandals. And that is a common theme. While injustices will always occur, they are compounded when there is no redress and no accountability. Too often, public bodies use unlimited funds to crush legitimate complaints, wage war on whistleblowers, and use non-disclosure agreements to hide the ugly truth from the paying public. Bad faith, back covering, and secrecy contaminate too many of our institutions. In Scotland, legal regulation is not fit for purpose, as we heard from Michelle Thompson. Our police complaint system betrays both the public and honest officers. Our prosecution service is capable of malice and routinely betrays victims. Our courts are secretive, self-serving and chronically inefficient. Our parole system treats victims as a nuisance. Our judicial complaint system is a toothless charade. In Scotland, sudden deaths are not automatically subject to public scrutiny, often leaving grieving families with no answers. This was very powerfully touched upon by Liam MacArthur. When rigged systems close the door on victims and close ranks to protect wrongdoers, what hope is there for ordinary people? Elsewhere in the United Kingdom, many of these very same serious problems have been identified and reformed to the benefit of the public. One of the most nauseating aspects of nationalism is the myth of self-righteous superiority and exceptionalism. The injustices I am speaking about here are entirely made in Scotland. This Parliament has the power to fix them, but the SNP prefer to dupe our citizens with a relentless diet of manufactured grievance and dishonestly blaming all our ills on Westminster. I've got a note here saying I would trigger Mr Dorn at that point, so thank you. Scotland deserves so much better. Rampant injustice and the dangers of Scottish nationalism are two reasons I decided to seek election. It's a maiden speech. I believe it's not convention. That's okay.
But you can if you want. There's no rule against it.
I'll crack on. I'm sure there will be another time. I'm fairly certain of that. But the catalyst for me standing here today came in the morning of December the 23rd, 2015. I answered my front door to a man dressed as a postman. He was, in fact, a hitman. He threw sulfuric acid into my face and tried to stab me. My young daughter witnessed this horror. She could have witnessed my murder. My subsequent personal experience of the criminal justice system confirmed everything I'd seen as a journalist. It made me angry. It made me realise that unless people stand up and be counted, nothing will change. To be thrust into the public eye has been a daunting process for me. I spent almost 30 years hidden from view because of the very real threat from organised crime. These gangs have become obscenely wealthy and immensely powerful. Their drugs kill record numbers of our people. There is more, much more to be said about this, and I will be saying it. It surprises me today in a debate about justice, not a single word has been spoken about organised crime. I'm grateful for all who have supported me and for the voters of the West of Scotland who put me here. I pledge to work hard for my constituents. Presiding Officer, Deputy Presiding Officer, I will conclude by returning to matters at hand. Today we have heard important contributions from members across the chamber, not least from Katie Clark and Faisal Chowdhury, who are also doing their maiden speeches today. It is heartening to hear so much consensus between the various parties. And I would simply add, today's Scottish Conservative amendment offers significant practical measures to begin the process of creating a fairer Scotland.
Thank you. And could I now call on Keith Brown, Cabinet Secretary, to wind up the debate for the government, and moving to decision time around five would be very helpful. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank all members for their contributions to today's debate. My first as Cabinet Secretary for Justice and Veterans. It has generally been, I think, informative and certainly wide-ranging, demonstrating, I think, a collective ambition to achieve a more effective justice system for the people of Scotland. And while, of course, there will be different views on how that endeavour might be achieved, I welcome the honesty and commitment that most members have shown to help inform that journey. I opened the discussion with a commitment to try and build consensus. You can see how difficult that is going to be, but where it is possible, I will try and do that. And I've tried to do that in the discussions which have already taken place with opposition spokespeople. I want to firstly repeat the aspiration for collective progress by this Parliament. It's a genuine aspiration. Today's exchanges have in no way diminished my appetite for collaboration, both in the context of the government's extensive and ambitious programme of commitments, but also as we look to ensure that our justice system is exemplary in its handling of victims, witnesses and the accused. I look forward to ideas, genuine ideas and suggestions as to how that best might be achieved, and I have no doubt that will lead to, if it happens, even more productive debates going forward. I think it's also important that we discuss in greater detail the range of levers currently available to justice partners as we emerge through the recovery phase of the pandemic and to consider what greater action may be possible. I said previously how impressed I was with the Remote Jury Centre initiative, which I witnessed yesterday, recognising those early concerns rightly raised by representative bodies at the start of the pandemic and the need for appropriate ongoing assessment and analysis. And that innovation has raised questions and delivered opportunities previously, if we're honest, not considered appropriate, and it's now a feature in our justice system, and actually one that's been looked at by justice systems worldwide in terms of the COVID environment and how to respond to it. Indeed, Scotland has been compared to other jurisdictions in leading the charge on this initiative, and it's a clear example of where further thinking on how these centres feature in the medium to longer term, that thinking is required and should be done so openly and publicly. If I can try and pick up on some of the key points made today, there have been so many, so please forgive me if I do miss anybody out. It's not intentional. Many of them have common themes. Can I first of all congratulate the other justice spokespeople, newer ones and those more established in that role, to their positions. I'll come back to the first of the speeches by Pam Gosel, if I could, towards the end of my remarks. Rona Mackay, I thank her for her remarks, especially in relation to the different approach to justice, a human rights-centred approach. Katie Clark, I congratulate her on her first speech. I also was a unison, I suppose, branch officer and Shropshire, never reached the exalted ranks of solicitor, but it was a great time to be in unison. I listened to the comments that she makes and found there was a lot of areas where I think we can agree. James Dornan, I think alone, raised the very important issue of sectarianism and anti-Catholicism, which we have to have regard to. Michelle Thompson mentioned the Register of Interest, which we will take forward, and many of her other comments are ones which I'm sure will be picked up by the Minister, who will have responsibility in the areas that she was talking about. Alexander Stewart, you know, I was keen to listen constructively, but really you can only do that from the basis of facts. You can have your own views, but you can't really have your own facts. And the simple fact is, in England, there has been a reduction of 17,000 police officers. In Scotland, we have over 1,000 more police officers than when we came to office. Crime has gone down substantially more in Scotland than it has elsewhere. Police officers are paid more in Scotland than they are elsewhere. So you can't invent or change these facts. And if you want to have a discussion about that, which I'm happy to be involved in, at least have regard to the actual facts which apply. Audrey Nicholl, I thought, had a fantastic speech, in particular mentioning well-being as a feature both of our justice system and of policing. Policing is much more than simply law enforcement. It is about the well-being of society. And like others, I thought Fazal Chowdhury's was an excellent speech. And can I say, although education is not my responsibility, the point he made about using education to teach some of the history, some history you might not want to face otherwise, about how we accumulated wealth in this country in the UK, is a very good point. I made it myself in a debate before the election, and I'm confident that the education ministers will be taking that forward. But I thought it was an excellent speech by Fazal Chowdhury. Christine Graham rightly highlighted the civil side, which is a huge part and probably impacts more people than the criminal side. In mediation, can I make an offer, a genuine offer, to say that I'm happy to mediate between her and Edward Mountain as to whose, as to whose pen that is, but I would warn Christine Graham that possession is 9/10 of the law, so the balance of... I will do very quickly, yes.
Christine Graham?
Your offer is rejected.
Cabinet Secretary?
We can but try. Can I also say to Emma Harper, made a number of very good points. Again, some of those points will be areas which the Minister will be responsible for, and the other points which I'm responsible for, I'm happy to respond to some of them in writing. It would take too long to do just now, but made a number of good points, not least in the location of jury centres. Pam Gosol, very much like Alexander Stewart. I mean, it may be the case that simply a litany of anti-SNP diatribes is the way to go. I just think if you want to have a genuinely constructive debate, that is not the way to go. And also, a dialogue is better than a monologue. So accepting an intervention, and it would have been a constructive one, I hope, would have been, I think, more helpful in terms of a genuine debate. And I hope that in time, she will be able to take genuine interventions and try and have a dialogue rather than the monologue. And really, we're not going to get to the... We're not going to get anywhere if we have, as I think we had before the election, simply trying to trash the entire justice and policing system in this country. Let's start from the fact, if there are things that are wrong, I accept that, and I'm willing to take on those challenges. But let's not try and trash the entire system and say that it's, you know, the worst in the world or whatever else it is. And Russell Finlay's points, he's right about serious organised crime. It wasn't mentioned and it is extremely important. And I would offer genuinely to him the offer made to me by the Chief Constable and others to talk about some of the work, not all of which we can do in the public domain, that is going on. Very serious work and very good work. I realise he'll have reservations about how effective it is, but I think that would help inform some of his views about what the police are doing. I thought the attacks on the SNP were just pointless, to be honest. It could have been a much more productive contribution to make. And once again, if we want to have a genuine dialogue, I'm happy to be involved in that. And I would say in some of the historic cases which you mentioned, he knows more about them than I do, and I accept that. The Criminal Cases Review Commission will actually look at these cases, and I'm sure they'll have tried that before. It's not for me to go and reopen former cases, but I'm not saying that some of the points he raised, especially the one about Mr McLeod, which I am aware of, are not serious cases, but these injustices are looked at in a particular way, and again, I'm perfectly happy to have a genuine discussion with him about that. So, very quickly, if I can turn to the amendments, Convener, there is much across them which I'm happy to agree with. There are a few areas I'd wish to highlight in the specific amendments. First, Labour's amendment supports, I think, our overall ambition for the justice sector. However, it's worth noting that decisions around domestic abuse courts and indeed all specialist courts currently is a constitutional matter for the Lord President and the senior judiciary. These are issues which I think should be considered. And I think Jamie Green made this point as well, the relationship between jury size and other aspects or juries and some of these changes proposed by Lady Dorrien should be considered, in my view, in the round. So I can't accept that, but I am willing to come back to that, and I'm sure we'll do very soon. I really don't have much time. I'm sorry. I'm trying to wind up. I've had less time than the opposition spokespeople so far. Apologies, but I don't have time to do that. In relation to the Lib Dems amendment on fatal accident inquiries, Parliament has agreed substantial reforms to the inquiries into fatal accidents and sudden deaths in 2016. It was passed with unanimous support, and additional resources have been applied, and it is having an effect. And I don't deny there are cases, some very high-profile cases, which give cause for concern. But currently, I think less than 2% of the fatal accident or sudden deaths have resulted in FAI, which have lasted more than 2 years, and we'll continue to work on that, but I can't accept, I'm afraid, that amendment. On the Conservative amendment, as much, genuinely, there is much we can agree on in relation to that. I agree with the need to continue to place victims and victims' rights at the heart of the justice system. I did try to cover that in my opening remarks, and I know we'll come back to that, both the Government and the Conservative Party, also on restorative justice and secure funding, but there's so much else, not least on not proven. If you are going to go with the proposal that the Conservatives mentioned, you really do have to consider the other aspects that are not proven in terms of size of juries and many other things in the justice system. And for that reason, I think it's important that we take that forward. And that's what the consultation will allow you to do. So I'm not by any means shutting the door on that, but that and the other points in the Conservative amendment I can't accept. Now, additionally, summary courts can already use their maximum sentencing powers in dealing with attacks on emergency workers. I think it was only the Conservatives that refused to support the legislation on emergency workers back in 2006. We are happy to support the Greens amendment today, including the commitment to human rights, very well articulated by Maggie Chapman, and the need to ensure holistic approaches to addressing underlying causes. However, it's worth noting that issues of enforcement, as is mentioned in the amendment against corporate and environmental crime, are operational matters for the appropriate regulatory authorities. And also, in relation to the point about institutional violence, which I think Pauline McNeill raised, I have spoken with the prison service and we have seen reports from the Inspectorate of Prison Services which say there's a very good relationship between prisons and prisoners, but the general thrust of the Greens amendment, especially in relation to human rights approach and some of the other innovations, we are happy to support. So with that, and with those positions on those amendments, Presiding Officer, I'm happy to conclude for the Government. Thank you.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on Justice, Recover, Renew, Transform. The next item of business is consideration of Business Motion 347 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out revisions to next week's business. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and formally moved.
Thank you. No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 347 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is consideration of Parliamentary Bureau motion 350 on a variation of standing orders. I ask George Adam, on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Once again, formally moved.
Thank you. The question on this motion will be put at decision time. There are six questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first is that Amendment 294.1 in the name of Jamie Green, which seeks to amend Motion 294 in the name of Keith Brown on Justice, Recover, Renew, Transform, be agreed. Are we all agreed? The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we will move to a vote and there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.